Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Ron Reck Show. And tonight, we are having a topic on targeted individuals. So, as the song I just played, are people being targeted, or is it just that, is their imagination, are they just so caught up in the scheme of life? You know, do we have a government that is actually targeting people? And we have Brother Drybones with us.
Yeah, you said you put the spell on their minds, huh? That was a good one. You must have put a spell on my mind.
Yeah, well, so is that what the government's doing?
I would believe the spell is real. I think people they take it lightly. I believe people don't understand that, yeah, they could put a spell in your mind. The government can actually have you thinking a lot of things. Seems to have been the case that we've been believing things that are not true. We come into the age of enlightenment. I think our minds are somewhat awakening because, man, the things they have us believing, and then we find out that it's not true. It's like they had us going a little bit crazy. They had me and you going a little bit. We were looking at November the 15th, 13th and 14th.
13th and 14th.
Yeah, yes, I think I think because so many people are becoming aware and they realize that they're doing these things, I think they know that, I think they're engaging, them. Let's see the chat rooms and all the internet stuff to see if people are aware. And once they see that everybody's on it, I don't think they do it. They stop.
Yeah, I think it messes up their plans.
Yeah, messes their plans up.
You know,
that's what they're doing.
That they won't do it later.
Right.
But they'll make sure it won't get out then.
Yeah, and you think if they give us another, I would think if something would have to happen. I think, you were talking earlier, this is their two money-making seasons here. You know, they got to have us eat good, eat all the food we can get. That's no good. Some people are going to be eating some serious GMO food on a high level.
Yes.
And then you got Christmas that's coming that they have for the manufacturing.
And Hanukkah.
And that's part of the manufacturing corporation part that they got you to buy.
Yes, and Hanukkah. Cannot forget Hanukkah.
No,
and
Hanukkah,
I know, is also included on Thanksgiving Day this year, because I know my granddaughter, you know, her mother already told me that they're going to be with her family, so she won't be with me for Thanksgiving.
Yeah, and then you got those who have changed Kwanzaa. They don't put all this together.
Christmas.
Right, even though they have great ideas behind it, it's still a manufacturing mechanism now that's maneuvered behind all that's going on. These holy, holy days, as they really are, they're holy to somebody.
Yes.
And we got to figure out who they're really holy for, and then maybe we might learn some things.
Yes.
But that is so true. Yes, I mean.
But for now, we have these people that they're being targeted, and they're suffering. You know, they're truly suffering. And, you know, it's sad because we have people that don't believe that they're suffering, and they're losing a lot of things. You know, as we heard earlier on Mr. Talk Show, that people are losing their children. You know, they're losing their homes, their way of making a living for themselves and their families. And then they're also being tortured. And for those that didn't lose their homes, they're being tortured in their own homes and in their own bodies.
Well, you have to think about these foreclosures that are illegal. First of all, that's tormenting you. That's tormenting you mentally, of depriving you of a roof over your head. That makes anybody stress out. And then beyond that, you got children and families is connected to your house without you really knowing, because anything that goes on inside your house, they automatically have rights to come in that has been usurped into the law of just taking control of your children and so forth. So not, you're being attacked by that as well. And then, like Mr. Wesley be saying, you have these electronic gadgets that give off these Wi-Fi vibrations that many people don't realize, like these frequencies, where the human body is a frequency being. I think it's low frequency. I don't think we can take high frequency. So basically what we're getting is being, if they know this, so they have different devices and different things that create these frequencies that can make tension in your mind. Even though you don't see it physically, the mind is vibrating at a certain level and it shakes the brain. And I know it's minute, so you won't go into epilepsy. Because, see, that's what seizures is about.
Yeah.
You call people to see seizures is electronic malfunction in the brain. The neurons happen to go into a burst mentality, and then it causes you to go into a shock, and they shake you. Well, they got machines and devices that can do that easily.
Yeah.
Can be aimed at an individual, and I know it sounds crazy, but it's been done. I almost can name a lot of people who we believe that had this done to them from all over the globe. I mean, all over the world. This is a global phenomenon of getting out of, getting at your enemies or those who they perceive to be enemies.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we have a lot of, and this is espionage. We're dealing with a lot of things. Espionage. We're dealing with, actually, if you think about the whole movement from, let's just say from the Black Panthers and all these women feminist groups, some of the other groups, they've been monitoring these groups for decades now. I mean, different organizations are monitored, especially during that era of the Civil Rights era. They were having a lot of covert. J. Edgar Hoover was doing COINTELPRO. Everybody who doesn't know, look up COINTELPRO. That was actually orchestrated by the FBI for a long period of time, and probably to this day, it's modified now. I mean, it's probably at the 100th power of what they can monitor.
Yes, the only thing they did was just change the name.
Change the name
of the program.
Change the name of the program.
Yes.
You know, just have, what's the one, MLK Ultra?
MLK Ultra.
That's right. Then you have, now Britain, this is how smooth this thing works. TV is behind it as well. The people who created the television propaganda machine, they knew in order to get this over smoothly. Remember we used to watch these James Bond movies? Many of us watched James Bond from Sean Connery days. They were doing those weapons back then.
Yeah.
They were showing us those weapons back then in James Bond movies because he was part of the Secret Service of Britain. And he was able to do all these magnificent feats with electronics and different maneuvers and different so forth. So it's there, but because it's in Hollywood, it doesn't seem real to us, but it's actually being done on a real level. And that's what's going on. But anything else, you know, I hope people, and we talked about this, me and you mentioned it earlier, and we just hope people just don't panic themselves to where they can't function. You know,
yeah,
don't let this fear overtake. Yeah, we don't want the fear to overtake when you stop functioning.
That is correct, because we don't want any more of the, you know, the people going on the shooting and, you know, shooting up the movie theaters or going to the Navy bases and, you know, all these different things. We don't.
Now, I want people to realize these holidays that are coming up, they could do maneuvers during this time, too. I just want people to be very aware of what, just don't be relaxed on anything. Be aware of things that are happening. They, you know, these are times when, you know, when people t- tend to go into a relaxed state because they believe, oh, we're at the end of the year. We got these two big holidays that we all worship. And then we got the big one, New Year's. And, you know, we tend to get relaxed. I want everybody to stay alert to things that are going on because, you know, nobody can tell what's going to happen during these few months. Too many covert operations have been done. And, matter of fact, I heard that it was the operations that was done, like I said, in California, they were doing. They had done the operation a week earlier in that same scenario. Mm-hmm. So they're doing these things. They're practicing, and then they're doing them.
Brother Drybones, I think we may have Tami Peppermint on the line. Let me check,
oh,
please.
Oh, my goodness. Yes, please. Let's see.
Yes. Hello, is this Tami Peppermint?
It is. How are you?
Hello, how are you? Welcome to
Wonderful.
The Ron Reck Show.
Thank you, hi.
Hello.
And
yes, ma'am,
I'm
we're fine.
I was listening just before, and it is absolutely disgusting, the urban pacification that's going on at any given moment in time, you know. People do get relaxed because they see law enforcement in the neighborhood all the time, you know, and they're watching their neighbors be taken, and they think they're being protected, you know, and you have to combat the media presentations at all times.
Correct. For those of you who don't know who Tami Peppermint, Tami, please tell people a little bit about yourself because I got learned about you a little bit a while ago, and I listened to some of your podcasts, and let me tell you, I was very much in thought of what you're saying 100%. And I just want you to just give an overview before we start to get deep and heavy with you. Just tell them what you're about.
Well, I have
yes,
a show,
please.
And I call it Leaving the Farm. This is a farm. Everybody lives on a plantation. The original colonies needs farm. Congress runs everything. Congress, through the Broadcasting Board of Governors, has international control of all civil media, and it's all a big show. When you go back to the foundation of the houses, house is stemming from marquee, which means a tent that you provide a carnival in, and that's what everybody's living under. They're living in the greatest show on earth, and the CIA is the Central Intelligence Production Agency. They actually are the producers on behalf of Congress, producing the show, and they do a very good job up until now when people are being awakened and realizing what they're doing, you know, because they're recycling their actors, and they're making it very, very prominent in even the mainstream media what they're doing, and they're being outed on that, and I'm glad to see people waking up and realizing what's going on.
Yeah, and it is an awakening. We had a show on about where the astral projection things of things on this earth. Now, I remember hearing you were giving some very esoteric information as well and how you presented your views, which made me really listen very deeply. You have already was saying how this is a corporation. This country has been pretty much what? In debt from the beginning. Am I correct from its very conception? Is that correct
to say? Absolutely. Everything that's ever gone on, the Korean War, Vietnam War, the slave trade, that was all Congress. They were shipping us all around and specializing some of us, making some of us feel really comfortable while the other of us are being abused. But before that, they would separate us in the mind and teach us that we're something different and that we're not all one thing. Or one being, and that's where we came in. We sued them in district court and won the case. We sued them for human trafficking. We sued them for basically the conspiracy. Confederacy itself, that word defined in Black's Law Dictionary, means a criminal enterprise.
Mm-hmm. And when you said you sued them in the federal court, that would be here in this particular corporation, or is this in another Corporation Canada, or where were you? What court were you in?
It began in U.S. District Court, and then it ended up in United States Court, which we founded after we were able to take their court over. And we won in August because they weren't even following their rules. They didn't have a judge there. And what that meant to us as humanity itself, we came in as the United States, what that meant was that, you know, here they didn't have a judge there. They had only attorneys in black dresses. We asked them to appear, and eventually we were able to declare them dead according to the SJKY Act of 1666.
Say that act again?
The 1666 SJKY Act.
Mm-hmm.
What they had done is the House of Lords came in through the British Parliament years ago. After they saw what Congress was doing in the 1600s, Congress had seceded all of our states. Secession does not mean to leave something. It means to take over a state, and that's what they have done. They took over our state by letters patent by creating the state name. And that last name was a description. They had described us, so therefore they were finding us under letters patent.
So basically they had already, so let's just say, to get everybody up to speed with this, they had British operators, proxies already in place over here on the conception that when they started taking over. So basically we became more controlled by the British Empire. Is that something that we can say is true?
No, absolutely not. What had happened was they came over here and they pretended to be under the Treasury. They said they were going to protect us. They facilitated a contract with the House of Lords called the Constitution. That contract went from Article 1 to Article 1, Section 9, Clause 3, and that was the end of the contract. They abrogated the contract in 1777 with the Articles of Confederation.
Okay. And now let me add a little bit more to this group. Most of these individuals are actually operating from a secret society perspective. Am I correct in saying that?
In a way, most of these individuals are just the directors of the Central Intelligence Agency. They have different names, they have different departments and different divisions, but they've always maintained as the same thing. They do go on to secret clubs and societies, but it's still the same actors. You know, I really, the secret clubs don't mean anything. It's the action itself that means something to me, the action of psychopathy.
Okay, but being that this was what's considered a Masonic republic, and most of the founding fathers were all Masons. Such words as constitutor, those are trick words because a constitutor is one who passes the dead on. So basically, they're using trick language on the people when they first came with this written document. Would that be correct?
Well, they used language against us from the inception because that is Babylonian theory. They had to design the human being to be what it needed to be through religious indoctrination, cultural indoctrination, and language itself. And once they taught us variants on language, that separated us from knowing who we were, knowing that we were the same family. We're always the same family. We were just shipped around through transportation, through the shipping industry, through the British East Indian Trading Corporation, Portugal when Portugal had it, Spain when Spain had it, Italy when Italy had it, and eventually they got it down to a science with the Confederacy.
What's this concept about the, a lot of people are talking about the Treaty of Friendship and Peace with the Moors, because the Moors have a lot to do with this the slave trade with England, and also they were also very important in them getting over here, and they're very much recognized in the United States and Morocco. What does that influence have? Because, you know, we were already, most blacks were already enslaved already at this particular time. And the Moors helped them. How is all that connected? Because it seems like there's a disconnect with the history. I know there's some type of connection has to come with that treaty because it seems to be very important to the United States.
Right. The treaties themselves, every treaty is an agreement between two banks to discharge bankruptcy. And so when any tribe or any entity enters into a treaty, they're giving human beings over to another entity by which to trick them out. So the Moors were probably tricked into that as well. All of the Indian nations were tricked into that. The Sioux and Iroquois and everybody else had signed treaties. But the word used in them, of course, everybody knows territories is land. That never referred to land. That referred to the human body. That means your earth. And when you go all the way back to the foundations of the words like Jesus, Jesus means your earth. That is the thing that's always been crucified since the inception of this game.
See, that's what I remember hearing you talk. That's what got me excited about what you're saying. So you're saying like the things that I like to hear. So say that again to the people who maybe that Jesus means what?
Jesus is a Greek and Latin word. It's G-E space S-U-I-S. It means your earth. And you've been being crucified since the coronation charter. All of the female estates were taken over by the king. The king said, if you lose your husband, we'll take care of you. And then they made sure that the females lost all their husbands because they killed them. At that time is when the king also let go all of the murderers, forgave all the murderers, which is the story of Barnabas in the Bible and the crucifixion itself. But the crucifixion is allowed by taking up names, by casting lots. And that's what that meant in Matthew 27. We are casting lots.
I'm getting an echo. It's an echo coming from somewhere. I don't know who
it's
has
still
it,
an echo. I don't know where it's coming from.
Yeah, I was hearing it when she talked. Now, Ms. Tami, so basically this is like an esoteric type of metaphor that we're dealing with here. We're dealing with esoteric and allegoric type of information, that these things that we think are human, but they got other connotations. Is that what we're saying?
Well, they are not human. A psychopath is missing the frontal lobe. It's not the evolved species. We are the evolved species, the human being. And the reason I say that is the frontal lobe is an evolution of our species. When we have the frontal lobe, we do have human empathy. We have compassion. We have feelings towards each other. But the psychopath does not. So it's able to view us as an object, as a thing, as a negotiable instrument, as a thing to trick out and prostitute. And that's just been happening since the 1100s. They got one over on us all through trick and deception because humanity doesn't think in those ways. We do not have those conceptualized thoughts to look at another human being and consider it as an object or a thing of value.
And so with the Vatican, with the QE Trust, they're the ones saying they have control over our soul. Is that the Vatican that says that?
No, the Vatican is a presentation as well. That the Pope means Father. There's a white Pope and a black Pope. That just means it was westernized and an easternized religion. They're all the same. They stem from the same text, which are the Homeric hymns, Homer. The history of Greece, the history of Sparta, those were all fictional writings by Homer.
Right. So that's where I'm glad you're going, because this is fascinating information here. So
yes, it is.
Because you know we just talked about this incident. Basically,
yes.
These books that many of the people are reading on a high level on Sunday is nothing to do with what they're reading. It has to do more with what you're talking about.
Absolutely.
They've been purposely deceived in reading these books then.
Absolutely. And that's what Jesus was saying. First Corinthians 6, Jesus said you can only fornicate by giving your body over to the Lord God as the landlord of your body. And God has both raised up the Lord God, so shall he raise us up as well. When you go into Revelation 19, you find that your name is the word of God. And Jesus had said that. He said, you are known by your works and actions. If you walk the word of God, that's your name. You are God. What happened was they perverted everything and taught you that you were something else so that they could own you. And again, we go back to the nomenclature. It means to grab something and name it. You have been named whereby they own you because they own the concept. You're buying from the law merchant.
I was just giving you actually that, law merchant. Now, would that be the story, does that go hand with the story when Jesus was fighting the money changers in the temple? Explain a little bit about that. How do you see that?
When you go back into the original charters, and especially the dialogue of the exchequer, you find that the chess game is only tricking out human beings. They have created a concept called debt and a concept called credit. And so when you're seeking to be, that's a credit state. You're hurrying up and you want to be, right now, I want to be this or that. I want to be a doctor. I want to be a teacher. I want to be a good mom. I want to be a good dad. I want to be a this or that. That's credit and debt. You are subscribing to their concept when in reality you are already a human being in the action and state of being. And in order to traffic you, or human traffic is humanity, they have to give you names so that you can be moved about as to psychology.
Mm-hmm.
This forces you to strive to be. You want to be anything. And when you go back to the foundations of what their laws are, statute means statement of compulsion. And that is the action of what FEMA is. Federal Emergency Management is a governor, which is a ship steer, divinator novice, steering you all around. Wherever it wants your vessel to go, you've been being steered in that direction and all the way off of your chosen path or your course through life. They've also been heading through the action of commerce and navigation.
So basically we're dealing with, when you say merchant law, for many, I know a lot of you people, a lot of you out there know, basically when we sign over these terms, merchant laws and vessel, that's why they use these terms with our birth certificate to go along with the birthing of a ship and all these the woman, we come out of the woman and the water bus. Is these like, these are actually a maritime law.
Absolutely.
Would that go along with Jesus walking on the water? Does that have something to do with him when he walks on water? Would that explain that part?
Absolutely. Jesus was walking on top of the Sea of Commerce. He wasn't in the Sea of Commerce.
Right.
And that's what that means. When you enter into contract and you're buying from the law merchant, you're purchasing from the snake in the garden, that's how Eve goes off. The judge comes at you and it says, well, you know what, I can give you a whole bunch of rice and I can give you a food stamps and I can give you medical insurance and everything else. Eve goes off to that through the action of hearts and minds, which is a war tactic. Hearts and minds is under fourth generation warfare. And that's how you lose the garden. Eve is the one that's giving up the garden.
Wow. Now, let's get on that, because I noticed that in some beginnings, usury came into this game. In the ancient world, usury was very taboo. The usury that came in here, and you see usury in the Bible, and many people still read this book, and it says usury is clearly a sin in this book. What makes people still believe in this type of thing called interest? Why would people follow it if they know? Is there some reason why they're doing this, or how they can get people to go along with something that is against their beliefs?
Well, it's from the education itself. Education stems from the word known as pedagogy. And pedagogy is actually meaning, what it means is attendance on boys. That is the removal of the firstborn son. When you go through these public schools, the Hitler Youth Camp, you're being taught that you are to facilitate and act within commerce. Well, going further than that, you know, you're required to know English and you're required to excel in English. English is the language of commerce. That allows you to be acting as a fiction, as a thing, because you're never at the first person instant. You're always at least four times away from the self within the action of psychology through language. And that goes back to Babylonian theory.
Well, they would say the Hammurabi Code? Is that what they would call it?
Well, it's language and psychology itself. First of all, you have the psychological implication or doctrine. Doctrine means to teach three times. and the three ways or the three variants of laws, metta, which is morality, soma, which is psychology, and veda, which is ethics. When you're taught those things move you outside of your relative state of being. Now you want to be a good boy, and you want to be a good doctor, and you want to be a teacher, and you want to be a cop, and you want to be a nurse. Those are all within the actions, metta, soma, veda. That is the way that you're being trafficked through the legal process, especially the medical industry, psychological industry, and the criminal industry, which are mainly the three forms of production. There's only three forms of production on this planet. Taxation and consumption is one-third of the global GDP. Medicine, psychology, and death is one-third of the global GDP. And criminalization is one-third of the global GDP. And the way that they do that is by division. They divide and conquer. They teach me that you're different than me. They teach you that I'm different than you. But we're not different. We're all the same beings. We just have different abilities. That's our only difference, but it's not a difference because our abilities, they complement each other.
So like the divide and conquer game is their primary motivation, like they use on it. Now, think about this on the money, the dollar bill and so forth. The dollar bill happens to be a very symbolic instrument. The picture, the caricatures, the pyramid, the eye of Horus. Why would you think they would make these, that put these on that type of exchange? Is it something they're trying to relate to the people that they only know and we don't?
Well, there's a lot of symbology. It's known as heraldry, being patriotic to your country or to your city or to your ball team and being patriotic to the dollar. They've taught human beings to worship that thing as a false god. That's a demigod. You know, and all of the rest of the symbology. You've got presidents that people look up to and flags that people look up to and pledge allegiance to. Those things are pirate flags. The bars that are laying down on their sides mean that you're captured under a pirate flag. This is all under shipping, known as commerce and navigation. That is actually piracy. Their original charters are charters on the high seas. Those are contracts on the high seas. And what's happened is...
Sorry about who they made the contract with, because it had to be two people or two entities. What would be the two entities that did these contracts together? Who are they?
It was just Congress. And what Congress had done originally, when you go all the way back to the original charters, they said, well, this guy's dead, but he said I should take all of you people, okay? Well, then eventually that wasn't working out very well, so they had to flip up the presentation. And then in 1777, they said, well, we, Congress, this the House and Senate, we're going to contract with the original 13 colonies. Well, the original 13 colonies is just a concept. It's just a farm, and it's maintained by Congress as their representative. So Congress was saying, we're contracting with ourselves, and the people at that time believed it because they were under so much force from by Congress itself. They've always been under fourth-generation warfare, where Congress says, no, it's that guy over there. Or like Congress says, it's the FBI or the Department of Justice or the CIA. Well, Congress is the father, the parent to all of those departments. That's Congress as well. It's just making it look, given an appearance to make it look like it's something else or decentralized form of government. But it is not. It's always been the House of Representatives and the Senate.
Well, is this really a government or just a corporation? Because in 1789, they're supposed to be a corporation. So are we dealing with this thing wrong because of the fact that many people think this is a liable government when it actually is not? And it's not in de jure. So
no,
what is it?
Not at all. And when you go to Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, let me bring that up and I'll read to you the definition of confederacy. Now, a confederacy is articles of agreement. That is a corporation. They were finding a corporation at that time. Let me get it for you. Sorry, it's taking me a minute. I was looking at a different word earlier.
No, go ahead. We're enjoying every word.
Yes, please take your time.
Oh, yeah.
And we have several people on the line, and I just want everyone to know that we are going to take your calls. I'm sorry if you've been holding for a long time. Please forgive me, but
I
don't want to.
Let's see what she takes today when she's ready to take some calls.
It's a hot subject
because this has been talked about for the last.
This is basically what our conversations cover.
Heavily, that's been talked about. We have so many trees and charters. You got the East India Corporation. You got the Islamic Corporation with the British. It's just so many things involved with this.
Yes, and I'd like to thank Nisi for getting in touch with Tami for me. I've been asking her for months, and she was finally able to get her. So I just thank Nisi for doing this for Ron Reck Show. And I thank Tami for taking her time and coming. And, of course, Dry Bones, I thank you all the time for just being here. I truly appreciate it.
Now, I want to say something, and by the time she finds this, I'm going to read this quote I have. And it says, in July 16, 1792, and in 1778, it was recognized the debt that Congress had with the bankers of the Crown of England, payable on January 1, 1788, but defaulted on by Congress. And this Rule 93 states that anyone who acts in commercial matter with one who is a debtor to another is no longer a natural party and stands in place of the debtor. So are they using us as the debtor?
Well, and on top of that, they redefined who the person was with the 14th Amendment. Abraham Lincoln was a monster. He wasn't a nice guy. When he did the Execution Act, he allowed attorneys to expatriate so they could take allegiance to the bar. And if you go back into his history, he was actually a credit reporter for Dun & Bradstreet at the same time. He just entered all of us into slavery, and he defined the corporation as a person. We didn't get any rights. The citizen was declared dead at that time, civilly dead. And again, we've been lost at sea, being able to be tricked out. And it's just been so disgusting because, and all it is those names. If you drop all of those titles and you come in as a sovereign state of being under 28 U.S.C. 97, which is the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act, you can hold them accountable because you only adhere to the public law. They don't have any immunity and they have absolutely no sovereignty as long as they're acting under acts of commerce and private acts according to the Commerce Clause Constitution.
I can't hear you.
We sued them under the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act, and throughout the case, we evidenced that they were human trafficking, they were acting under acts of commerce and private acts, and they didn't have an argument. They couldn't argue it. They can't say, well, no, I'm not, because every county is a foreign nation. They're all acting under acts of commerce and private acts stemming from the law merchant itself. The defamation of the law merchant went into the Negotiable Instrument Act. Then when the Negotiable Instrument Act was superseded by a Uniform Commercial Code, that's all it is. That's one big compilation of acts of commerce and private acts. And private acts are executive.
Now, let me ask you, there's been a big movement. I'm sure you know some of the main characters, different groups were filing these papers to get the commercial code and going into Congress, and it was done, many hundreds of thousands of people were doing it. I know some people myself. What is the ramifications of, and what do you think the impact of that is? Is it helpful?
Because Congress offers you a remedy, not a cure. You'll never get anything out of it. It's actually subscribing back under UCC, you don't want them to have jurisdiction over you. You are God. You have jurisdiction over them. And in your walk as God, you are a sovereign state. You're not a citizen or a subject of anywhere. You're a sovereign state. as defined by the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act, there is no other sovereign state.
And I agree with that, and I understand that quite well, but I'm just going to use it in the press, because you went to court, and I want you to explain some of the things that came out of that and how y'all succeeded. But if we're God, which is in the Bible, ye are God's children of the Most High, if we're God, then why would we have to ask them permission anyway? I mean, why would we have to solicit papers to them to make that statement? If I'm God, I don't think I should have to ask them anything.
No, never. And what had happened when we sued them, when we came in as a sovereign state, we didn't appear before them. We only came in as evidence by the documentation. And what that means is that we put all of our evidence on record. We never physically went into court. You don't go into court because once you appear, you're appearing as a special deposit, regardless of any of the games that you played, or if you put a stamp on the paperwork, or if you put your blood thumbprint on there, like a lot of those processes. That just gives them jurisdiction. The action of appearing before them says that you are a deposit in the bank. And I'll define that after I read your confederacy, because the court is actually the bank, defined in Black's Law Dictionary.
That's right.
Now, the definition of confederacy in Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, says, in criminal law, the association or banding together of two or more persons for the purpose of committing an act or furthering an enterprise which is forbidden by law, or which, the lawful in itself, becomes unlawful when made the object of the confederacy. Conspiracy is a more technical term for this offense. The act of two or more who combine together to do any damage or injury to another, or to do any unlawful act. Now, at the very bottom, it says, the federal government.
Mm-hmm.
They've always been a criminal enterprise. And what they're doing, when you go into court, that judge has an oath to discharge congressional bankruptcy under 28 U.S.C. 453, subsection 453. That judge declares an oath to Congress, and it says, I am going to use these individuals, whatever they're claiming to be, to discharge your bankruptcy. That is the action of human trafficking by their own act. And that's how we won the case. I just put on act after act after act after treaty after treaty after treaty, because when it began, we came in and we said, you know what, you're trying to post me, because they were trying to post us under the last name, which indicates that we're a felon. If you check your mail and you go outside right now and you get a piece of mail out of the mailbox that has the first, middle, and last name on it, you are committing a felony under 18 U.S.C. 1342, subsection 1342, unless you're using the proper name. The proper name is only your first and middle name. The cognomen is the last name. Now, that thing is a description. So when they found my family, my maiden name is Erickson. That describes me as Erickson. There's Johnson and there's Smith. That indicates that you're Black Smith and Silversmith. That's a description of you as a piece of property. And that's how they facilitated the letters patent. That's what the letters patent are on. They're not on any ground. In the Articles of...
No, go ahead.
In the Articles of Confederation, the United States of America is a style, S-T-I-L-E. The first sentence says it's a style. That means it's a chain of events. It's not a geographical state. It's only congressional action. It was never geography. They just
opened up a can of worms. That opened up a lot of can of worms because, like you just said earlier with the names, so now, because we're so divided on ethnic backgrounds, so for, say, for instance, Black America, who's saying, oh, I'm not a part of this because, you know, this is the slave master's name and so forth. Now we're running into a whole bunch of that going to be taking place because our names ain't really what our names was. And then you got people who said that we were the indigenous people. There's a belief system that's out there through a lot of archaeological findings that this is the indigenous land, and a lot of indigenous were black people. So how is that going to, I mean, going to court, and how's all that, can you see the spectrum of how big this is going to get when it really opens up? Plus, they should be tried on treason, because isn't that really what they're doing? They're treason.
Genocide. They're coming up against the human race. These are psychopaths. They're not the same race as we are. They're perpetrating genocide against the human race. Now, my skin is very light. I sound white. I'm not white. I was born black. They moved me to a northern hemisphere country. They moved my family to Sweden, and it forced us to be white because we didn't have the sunlight. Do you realize that white people suffer the most from rickets because they're sick?
Mm-hmm.
That's an illness. To be white is an illness. We were all black before Jesus out of our garden. We were all on the equator. We never moved anywhere. We didn't have to. They decided to move us.
Now, that's where I'm coming from. Now, see, with that information, which is accurate, now you're going before a court that is part of the Scottish Rite. Most courtrooms are Masonically put together. The judge is sitting in the east. The two prosecutors are the two pillars. I mean, this thing is set up just the way they've been had it planned. How are we going to fight this?
I know we're right.
And I know you're right, what you're saying. Give me a solution, because you said you won. Explain the outcome of how you said you won. That way we can get a little...
We just now facilitated the final order indicating that they've been perpetrating genocide against us. That was done on the 28th of October. But in March, we cut off their funding. They were cut off from the IMF. They're not getting any more special drawing rights because we evidence that they're not protecting us. They tried to appropriate out of the Treasury here recently when they have the government shut down. They could not. They got $313 billion. That's not even enough to cover their overhead. Because we have indicated through the House of Lords and evidence to the House of Lords that they are not facilitating the contract to take care of human beings. They're preying on us as constant.
And I want you to give them that website and how we can pull that up, because that's some fascinating. That sounds like a good read right there. Do you have that on the site? On your site,
yep.
So we can...
And in fact, chooseyourside.org.
Okay.
And the basic process is that you have to evidence your intent to not be a citizen of the United States Incorporated and not be a prisoner of war, because what had happened, they came in 1929 to the Geneva Convention and said that anybody without a government was going to be saved by them and entered into holding corporations as prisoners of war. Well, of course, Congress went bankrupt in 1933, so there's no government.
Right.
That means corporations are required to pick you up as a prisoner of war until you find a government. Nobody's patronizing their own house. So you need to patronize yourself as a government. You are in a holding corporation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we did the agreed entry in May with Northern Holding, and they agreed with us. We said, it's unlawful for you. We are giving you immunity for this time right now as you read this order, because you've been human trafficking. Now, if you hold human beings in your holding corporation anymore, we are going to charge you our fee schedule, which is on record. And they agreed with us. We entered into the agreed entry in May. Now, these charges... E-Force, and it stems all the way back to, quote, Sparta, the illusion of Sparta. These magistrates are the things that were directing back then. And when it comes to the Masonic illusion that everybody sees, my grandfather was a 32nd degree Scottish Rite. Now, he was the philanthropist. He was paying the local community. He was putting money into these foreign nations and everything else without realizing what they were about. But they are not the directors. The general counsel and the corporate counsel are the directors of policy. And when you go all the way back in time, the story of Robin Hood, when Robin
Hood, Rob
Child. Robin Hood was robbing from the rich and giving to the poor, he was actually robbing the Pope. And that's where the corruption stems from. They were protecting the banks, the original banks, which were the Pope.
That's right. And to this day, the Jesuits and so forth. Now, we have some callers. Do you want to take some calls, just, you know, a few of them, to give you some answers to them, or how's that? You want to do that for a minute?
Sure. I was going to read the definition of bank real quick.
No, go ahead. Read it.
The definition of bank out of Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, says a bench or seat. The bench or tribunal occupied by the judges. The seat of judgment, a court. The full bench or full court, the assembly of all the judges of a court. A sitting-in bank is a meeting of all the judges of the court, usually for the purpose of hearing arguments on demurrers, points reserved, motions for new trial, etc., as distinguished from the sitting of a single judge at the thesis or nisi decreas, and from trials at bar. But in this sense, bank is the more usual form of court. Number two, an institution of great value in the commercial world, empowered to receive deposits of money, to make loans, and pay to its promissory notes, designed to circulate its money, and commonly called bank notes or bank bills, or to perform any one or more of these functions. Now, every time you appear before a judge, you are going in there as a deposit. The court process itself is called negotiorum gestio. The attorney is called the negotiorum gestor. It's the thing that negotiates you, the negotiable instrument, with the judge.
And that's exactly why they always say your bond is set, so because they have money placed on it. Now, I'm going to ask you another question. Now, because many people may know and many people may don't know, these Black Law Dictionary, which I have, explain to the people why everything's in Latin. Why is all our court jargon is Latin?
Latin is two things. It's the language of the dead and the language of contract. And what Latin does is it contracts by accent other languages. That is actually the foundation of Babylonian theory, or Babel, what Babel is. Because in English, you are actually speaking Greek and Latin constructs without realizing what these words mean. Like, to comprehend something means to take it. If you comprehend something, you've been stolen. Appropriate means to take. Secession, or seceding something, means to take over an estate. All of these words have been perverted and taught to you as English, but at their foundation, they mean something entirely different.
Exactly. So it's like color of law. These words have total different meanings.
Absolutely. And Bo went into that on the Bo and Rocco show the other night, this Wednesday. I can get that out to people. I have it on my Facebook wall. But he explained that as well, with color of language, the medical industry, psychological industry, and everything else. And he also read the most recent order on air.
But so he kind of echoed. Say that one more time. I didn't hear you.
Bo had read the most recent order on the air the other night on the Bo and Rocco show.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, give us that information. Please give me that information, because I want to be able to go on there. I'm gonna give you my information so you can contact me so I can go on these shows and hear you guys, because you're full of so much information. We're going to take probably one call, two calls to get a little started, because we still have a lot of time left. Let's take one.
Okay. 678, your line is open. You have a question or comment?
I would actually like to give people who've been waiting an opportunity to say what they want to say, because what I have to say can wait.
Okay, we appreciate that. That's
okay,
all.
Thank you. Okay, 111.
Which one?
Yeah, well, it must be you. You're talking.
Okay.
Hello,
right.
Joe.
Hey, Antoinette. Well, let me see. Do people realize that the Masons of today are not the same as the Masons of George Washington's time?
Uh-huh.
Well, when you go back to the etymology on Washington, that name was actually a concept. He didn't exist. And when you go back to the original charges of the 1600s, 1700s, You know, you can see that he didn't exist. And the etymology actually says Washington means the state of a man named Waso. Well, Waso stems from the word vassal, meaning a subject of something or one who pledges allegiance to another lord, god, or landlord. George Washington was simply a concept or an illusion. It was a presentation to teach us to be subjects.
So let me get this straight then. You're saying Washington did not exist?
Absolutely not. And you can see this in the Charter of Virginia and the Second Charter of Virginia.
Okay, hold on. I'm going to piggyback on that one. So when you say Washington did not exist, now you know that is going to make a lot of people say, hmm, because you have information, because I want to check this out myself. The physical Washington that you're saying, George Washington, never came over here, and it's an allegory.
Right. There were people here. It's just that particular individual did not exist as a human being. It was a concept.
So who was the considered first president of the United States?
Well, the president, that word, the administrator, is a clerk or clergy on behalf of Congress or somebody else. All that means is it's the voice of. So by media theory, through the presentation, through the, and again, going all the way back to House means literally from the past marquee. It was just always a presentation. It's always been the greatest show on earth in order to garner us and lead us to where we are now, and society now is in a politically correct state. They're completely and absolutely away from their nature.
So let's say Washington didn't exist. Okay. At which time do we believe the presidents do exist? Let's say Washington exists, so maybe, I forget who the second president was, Adams, maybe Adams didn't exist?
John Adams, I think you're referring to.
Yeah, whoever the second president was.
Adams.
Oh, I don't even know who that is.
Yeah, you're right. Go ahead.
All right, so do we believe that Adams existed, or do we believe he was a concept?
Well, when you look at the etymology on Adam, it means man. That Adam means man.
Uh-huh.
Then you have Maddie's son, which is Madison, Washington Adams Madison. Then you have Monroe, and if you go back to, like, the Monroe Doctrine, you can see that those are a whole bunch of concepts that they were feeding us and everything else, and you go all the way through. I think
Dolly Madison, the cupcake.
Yep, and it's all of these concepts and illusions that we have to fight against.
Let me ask you this. At which time, which particular president can we believe in actually existed? The 5th, the 6th, the 7th, the 8th?
Well, you can see the actions of, when I look at the actions of, like, Jackson and the Nullification Proclamation, it appears that he did exist. Somewhere around in there, maybe. I know that Lincoln existed. He was a credit supporter for John and Bradstreet. But you have to take into account the media at that time was presented in book form, and it was slow to be occurring. So on the East Coast, they could do something, and 2 or 3 years later, the West Coast would hear about it.
Can I ask you a question, Joe?
Don't you kind of feel like you're oversimplifying the discussion when you're talking about the actual existence of presidents? You know, we can debate it and we can argue it. However, it's documented, so we can talk about John Henry Adams. We can talk about Thomas Jefferson. We can talk about, like the madam alluded to, which was Lincoln, and how he wasn't the president that everybody thought he was, or how he was portrayed in history. And we can talk about George Washington. Isn't that true?
When you go back to Greek and Sparta as well, you go back to the Homeric hymns. The Homeric hymns were interpreted by attorney, and there's books, 10 volumes of books put out called The History of Greek, as portrayed by the attorney. And then that became our history. That was fed through the public school system to us. And again, if you go read the Treatise on Education, otherwise known as Emile, you can find out right away, immediately, that has always been a presentation by which to move us outside of our PE.
And let me share something with you, sister. Let me share something with you. I got educated that same way, so I'm not asking the same type of questions. Matter of fact, I haven't asked you a question at all because I know exactly where you're coming from. And when we're sitting on this line and all these people are asking, okay, this is some deep information. No, this is information that's been put up in your face ever since you've been on this planet.
Yeah.
You didn't know it? You didn't know it? It's been thrown up in your face. I don't care if it's 100 years old, 500 years old, 1,000 years old, 2,000 years old. It's right in your backyard.
That's right. Hey, we got another caller. So let's take another one then. Let's get another caller. So
yes,
we do. Let's get another one.
Okay, give me one moment. Okay, area code 404.
Oh, hey, how y'all doing? Nothing to say, man.
Hello, Wesley.
Hey,
you
how you doing, Miss Antoinette? Yeah, I'm just
listening.
Hello,
I'm well.
I'm smart meter off, but I do have one comment. That just proves every fucking thing about America is a damn fucking lie, okay? And so that's all I got to say.
That's right. I appreciate that one. Next, you got one more. Go back.
He got right to the point. He got right to the point.
Right to the point. Give me one more caller, then we'll go right back into Miss Terry going to some more information for us. Go ahead, one more caller.
Okay. All right, I just went to four. Okay. Area code 561. Area code 561.
Yes, I feel the same way Wesley did.
Hello, Miss Elvira.
Hello, dear. Excellent show.
Thank
you. I have somebody to talk to about a show, so if you can contact me.
Yes, ma'am, I will do so.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Great show. Thank you. I really enjoy your show.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is very good.
Thank you. I enjoy you coming.
Thank you.
Now,
I hate it when you're not
here. I'm sorry.
I'm going to ask her one more thing because I know there's a couple other people. Mr. Evick, Roger Evick, he's similar in the same type of vein of what you're saying here. When you won your case and everything went through, what was gained? Can you tell us what was gained so we can get some ideology of how it can empower us when you did this, or you and your group did this? How long did it take?
Almost a year to get everything established, to come in as the sovereign state, to evidence that we were a sovereign state, to evidence the trust, which was so important, to walk away from each other. Now, males and females have been taught we're two different things. We don't trust each other. We run off to the fiduciary. We're trusting that snake in the garden. And at that time, when you trust that snake in the garden, Moses was a judge. That's the one that came down the hill and said, you all are killing each other, stealing each other's wives and asses. That was not happening. He told you that so that you would require his protection, which is the action of Leviticus. The Old Testament is actually their manifest. And what happened was Jesus came in. We know he existed because he's written about in their own law, in the Coronation Charter, in the Bull of Pope. That was a reaction to whoever Jesus was walking around back then. And they were arguing directly against him, and he was arguing against them and telling them, look, you're going to be held accountable for this. You are going to be held accountable for human trafficking. You're going to be held accountable for each and everything that you do upon the children. And the millstone is going to be wrapped around your neck. And that's what he says in Matthew 18. Well, what I did was I followed those rules, what we did. We all came in at the same time as the United States. And eventually, because we couldn't find them, we were looking for judges bound by judicial canons. That is what maintained the court. Now, we didn't find any judges. We found bankers, and we found attorneys, and we found all of these fictions. So our only option was to declare them dead. They are not living beings.
Uh-huh.
And that was the agreed entry with Northern Holdings and Trust, because Northern Holdings and Trust, or any holding corporation, can only be holding negotiable instruments. They can only be holding dead things. They can only be holding prisoners of war without a government. Well, we came in as the United States, all lowercase.
Let me ask you a question, because that's at the time, let's just take that concept, what you would say were construct. Well, let's just say the Bible that you're using, the scriptures that you're coming from, written by and authorized by King James, Sir Lancelot Andrews, Sir Francis Bacon, his 54 men, wrote this thing together. At the same time, they were constructing the slave trade, because the first slave trade ship was called the Good Ship Jesus. So is this thing basically a slave book that we, and that's why you're able to get the symbolism out of it? Because it seems like that's, I can't hear you.
The whole foundation of the religious texts are based on the game of chess known as the Court of Exchequer. The Court of Exchequer is actually a board game. It's a chess board. And when you go to the dialogue of the Exchequer, the rule book, you find that it's the game of chess plus the game of risk. Now, the game of risk is the insurance aspect of all of this. Then that wraps around the game of chess. But in the game of chess, it's the same as Roman law. It's winner take all. So they had declared us dead years ago because we didn't have a government. We were patronizing somebody else, and we had vested power in Congress. We told the Lord God, here, take me. I'm yours. And then we started patronizing it and calling it Father. That's what patriotism is.
Patriotism is a very, we just talked about that. Remember we said the other night, patriotism is a very serious thing. They can get you hooked on that word.
That's why it's historical. That's why you got to go back.
Well, that's why you're right.
There's an origin to all of this. There's an origin that has manifested itself.
Now, she said chess. Now, let's be honest. I've seen a lot of ancient chess symbols. I've seen Kemet in Egypt. They have chess.
No, chess boards. All chess boards are the same.
The Moors in Spain had chess boards.
I'm sorry, bro. No. All chess boards are the same. In diameter, in angle, in everything. They're mathematically perfect. So when you start talking about other pieces, that's
I didn't say that. I said chess is seen on the Kemet, on the wall of the Kemet, you see them playing chess. You see the Moors playing chess in Spain at the time. I didn't say anything about size. I know the game. I play chess. What I'm saying is the origin goes into the ancient time. Explain that concept. Did that come out of Egypt? Because they have the first chessboard.
That's why we're given the imagery of the grand chessboard. Mm-hmm. That's why that everything goes back to a fraternal organization, whether you're Greek. Whether you're this, whether you're that, it goes back to something that's very basic. So in regards to what you're saying, and I'm going to sum it up real quick, is that, yes, that chessboard exists. It has never changed, and it is built off of the above
concept. It's somebody standing over the
chest. So above, so below.
Right. And that's how the game is played. Somebody stands over the chessboard, and then somebody else has to be the pieces. And what we did in our case was we stood over the chessboard, and they became the pieces. Mm-hmm. Now, in the dialogue concerning the Exchequer written in 1180, there's a question posed by the disciple, and he says, what is the Exchequer? The master says, the Exchequer is a quadrangular surface about 10 feet in length, 5 in breadth, placed before those who sit around it in the manner of a table. And all around it has an edge about the height of one's four fingers, lest anything placed upon it should fall off.
That's sacred geometry.
Right. Placed on top of the Exchequer, moreover, a cloth bought at the Easter term. Not an ordinary blue one, but a black one marked with stripes, the stripes being distanced from each other from the space of a foot or the breadth of a hand.
Exactly.
Excuse me. I have two other callers online that have been holding for a while.
Let's take another call. She's talking about sacred geometry now.
Yeah, I know.
Yes. Excuse me,
Aunt 2K. Go ahead.
Okay, 111. 111. Blocked or Skype caller. You have your hand up. Do you have a question or comment? Or do I not have you in here?
There you go. Now you've unmuted.
Oh, I'm sorry, Joe. You came back. You left me.
Yeah, I got cut off.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Joe's back.
Not by me.
Isn't that now?
Back to, we just spoke about.
Okay, we have another caller.
This is astrotheology, almost the same. It's like a combination of everything together. Oh, go ahead. Take one.
Yes. Okay, area code 404.
Yeah, I got a question. Yeah,
okay, Brother Wesley, yes.
Yeah, I got a question. She keeps saying about the dead, okay? Is she referring to the original Masons, like Hiram, that was hit in the head, that stolen from us, because we were original Hiram, the original Masons. So when you refer to the dead, who are you talking about?
The dead is one that doesn't know its own authority. And so for all of your life, most people patronize something else. They're the walking dead because they're acting as a fiction. They're subscribing to the concept of that last name and being patriotic to other things rather than patriotic to themselves. And in that, they're seeking to be. They want to be. They want to be a good boy. They want to be a good girl. When you want to be something, of course, that's coveting. That's the only sin. Is coveting, you want to be, you're not actually relatively being. And when you're able to take up your authority, you're no longer that dead individual.
Well, I don't consider myself dead. I consider myself I am, okay? And that's the problem. The people that sleep, that's the problem. That's the whole deal. When you refer to the dead, it's the people that sleep, like everybody else walking around this country. We are the original one. We are I am. I don't want to be nothing. I know I am, okay?
Absolutely.
So that's all I got to say.
Can I interject here just for a second? Because I feel exactly what she's saying. And what she's talking about is on a spiritual level. It's not on a material level. And people who know me, I talk about this all the time. This solar system, this planetary system, this system that we live in is the only place that we know of in the universe where spirit and matter come together.
Uh-huh. One word. Universe, one word.
Yeah, universe. There you go.
That's right. And the reason why I brought that up is that all this stuff we're talking about, frequencies, being people being turned this way, people being subjected to this, people going through this, people going through that, there's a common link in all that. Even though the experiences are different, we all know something is happening that is not natural.
Uh-huh. Very cool.
It's not natural.
People getting to wake up, man. People, the dead is not waking up. And that's the whole thing about this targeting, is the fucking microwave, the dead and getting conscious and waking the fuck up. And this all that jibbity-jabbity, this American and British wicked shit is coming to an end. This 6,000 fucking devilish rule that y'all talking about is over, okay? The God's people getting conscious, the third eye waking up. And we coming to the real righteous order, and so y'all get ready, because the hole is beginning to open, the new dimension, the righteous folks is coming through this portal, and so y'all better get ready to ride through it. Y'all, that's all I got to say. Y'all better get ready to ride through it. But this whole paradigm is shipping.
I agree. Hold on. Let's go now. Let me ask you,
Sister Agonia. Sister Agonia, do you have a question or a comment?
No, I'm just enjoying this dialogue, and it's just wonderful, wonderful. Greetings, Tami.
Well, I know you've been looking forward to Tami Pepperman, so I'm sure you have something to add.
I'd just like to Oh, I'm sorry.
Wait a minute. Excuse me, N2K.
My bad.
Sister Gonya.
Yes, I'm, okay. That's it, honey. I thank you so much, and greetings to everyone. I just want to
listen. Thank you, honey. Thank you, sir.
Okay. N2K,
and
I have to ask you to make it brief.
Here's what I really like. You have somebody on your show tonight that I could feel what they're talking about. In spite of all these arbitrary instruments and how life is supposed to be, and this is the second time this has happened tonight where I heard somebody on another show who I could hear in their voice was pleading out.
Yes.
And I'm on your show, and I'm hearing this woman talking with conviction. She ain't just throwing stuff up in the air. She ain't just trying to get people to believe something. She talking about something that's happening in her life. And the worst thing I could do, is not acknowledge that. And I just wanted to say, to y'all, I'm going to put myself on mute, just like Allfax does. You know, that's the old saying on PPR. I'm going to put myself on mute. But I just want you guys to know that I loved it. I love hearing what she had to say. I'm feeling what she had to say. And there was somebody that was talking earlier who was speaking on that same emotional level, man, and I feel a pulse going through this earth. That's all I can say. That's all I know, man. I feel that electricity.
Yeah, that's what it was about.
No more
go
fear.
Ahead,
the word apocalypse comes from the Greek words apo and kalypton, meaning to bring forth from a hidden state. Revelation means to reveal. We are making ourselves known by our words and actions. The psychopath does that as well. It evidences its walk by its works and actions. That is the mark. You have the mark of God by your works and actions. You have the mark on your hand by your work, and you have the mark on your forehead by the things that you teach. It is the same with the psychopath. By their works and actions, they're marked on their hands by the mark of the beast. By the doctrines they teach, they're marked on their forehead. And that is written in Matthew as well. Now, in Revelation 19:12, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God.
But ma'am, can I interject? Let me interject this right here. She said the mark of the beast is on your head. No, ma'am, it's in your head. When they get in people's head and their brain and start doing this electronic magnetic manipulation, that mark of the beast is in your head, not on your head. Okay? That's the deal. It's in your head. And when they talk about the temple getting rebuilt, you know what they're talking about? That's not talking about no damn building. That's talking about the temple between your ears, your brain, your conscience, your God consciousness. And so the temple is getting rebuilt between your over your ears, you got temples, right? And so once that consciousness gets in between your temple, the temple of God is being rebuilt, okay, as we speak. Now that's coming from the order of the Creator. I had to let y'all know that.
I got a question before I came on back. At what point in history can we believe that which president was actually the president as opposed to a concept?
You have to go all the way back to
Kennedy.
Kennedy.
He was the only president of the United States.
Excuse me, N2K, can we let our guest speak, please?
Let the guest talk. Go ahead.
When you go all the way back, you can see who's real and who's not by their works and actions. Like I said, Lincoln existed. Now, before that, Jackson existed. I don't know about the first presidents because when you see them written about in the original charters, a lot of times they were already dead. They were defined as something else. Pembroke, for example, you've got William of Pembroke. That was William Shakespeare himself. You know, you've got all of these different concepts, and
Okay, you're saying Lincoln. Lincoln we have photographs of. Now, before him, I'm not sure if Pierce came before him or after him. Jackson came before him, but you don't really know.
Jackson was before him. Adams was before him.
But, okay, that's a good question, though, because I'm confused. That's
Jackson,
very, that's
Adams, McKinley. Oh, no, McKinley was after.
Okay.
Yes, right.
But here's the thing. Let's get this clear so we can get, because I love what we're talking about. Now, you just mentioned William Shakespeare, who has a lot to do with this Bible that we're reading. I'm noticing that the same.
Uh-oh, you really want to get into that?
The same characters are also the ones who write in this Bible that we have, Black Law Dictionary, Bouvier's Dictionary, which is the French version. I mean, it's all coming from the same pool of people. You know, that's where you have to say to yourself, okay, if these people wrote in deceptive ways, I mean, who's to say what they're really saying?
Okay, let me answer that.
I want the guest to answer that. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, my bad.
Yeah, Ms. Peppermint, please.
Please, thank you.
Again, you are absolutely correct. William Shakespeare wrote plays. They were fictional creations. That taught us kings. That taught us all sorts of stuff, including Julius Caesar. The story of Julius Caesar and all of these things. Caesar's referred to in the Bible when Jesus was walking around. They said, should we pay homage to Caesar? And he said, show me a penny. You know, all of that thing. Well, then you go to the construct of time, and time has been constructed for you. When you go all the way back to the separation of the spiritual and the temporal, which was an ordinance by William I, that's what he was separating. When you go over to neuropsychology or neuroscience itself, you find that the big part of the brain, which is called the corpus callosum, is separated into two parts. Those two parts are called diastri and cura, which is district and circuit, court. It's a psychological construct. But then you go to the 1789 Judiciary Act, and that says that wherever you are in court on a given day in the United States, you are actually in court in Massachusetts or in Pennsylvania or in New Hampshire. They've created all of these illusions so that you can play into this game by legal process. And when you go to the etymology on law itself, the word law means to lay down.
Uh-huh.
Well, what's the opposite of laying down? Resurrected, to be resurrected, to stand.
Who was going to ask a question before?
I have one. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Now, you asked a question about William Shakespeare. William Shakespeare was a pen writer. He was a ghostwriter who was actually writing that, which is documented in history, is Sir Francis Bacon.
Right. We mentioned him earlier.
At the time of Queen Mary, which is where you get the drink Bloody Mary.
Correct.
Because she killed people. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. No, I just had to throw it in there.
No, he's right. He's right.
Okay. Okay. One of the first things they teach you as a young child, what's one of the first things they teach you? Is to connect the dots.
When you look better, it left your body, the germs.
I want to get this. You're saying that Sir Francis Bacon was really William Shakespeare, and William Shakespeare was just a pseudonym.
Exactly. William Shakespeare was a ghostwriter.
Well, hold on. Let me get this going on.
He was a ghostwriter, and all you have to do is go back and study English history from the 1,000 years up until 1700.
He's considered a ghost. It's a ghostwriting club, but it's 54 of these individuals that came through different time periods to put this book together, this compilation together. Now, I know she's very well, and mostly everybody in here. See, remember we talked about this the other day. Everybody who's on here is pretty well versed in school. we're trying to figure out how to get this type of information to others.
In the same way, brother, let me respond to that. The same way we're doing it now.
But then look how many people, and Tami, tell me what you feel about this.
What are you?
Tami, look how many people who say they believe in the Bible.
Somebody's talking.
Yeah, I'm trying to find it.
That's not me.
It's not me.
Tami, we got a million plus people, all ethnic colors. If they were to hear your version, which I agree is, it makes sense to me. But
her version is the blueprint.
You're not listening. I said, your version, if they heard your version, they would almost think that you were a devil, the Antichrist, the way you're describing yourself. How do you deal with that?
Throughout my walk, I've been called a heretic. I've been called anything else under the sun. All I do is speak the truth and walk forward. Jesus said if we're not accepted to just walk on and kick up the dust off of our shoes, we're not allowed to just... I can't steal anybody away from the other Father. And that's what they're patronizing. They're patronizing our Lord God. They're patronizing Satan. The word of term means to turn and to pay homage to another Lord God. That attorney is Satan. That is your adversary. When you go to the etymology on the word Satan, it means adversary. That's the thing that's against you, the human being. And I can't tell anybody about them, but,
Tami,
you know,
Tami, the one thing that you haven't shared with them, which I'd like you to do right now, is from an etymological standpoint, explain to them where the word Lord comes from. Where does that come from?
The word Lord comes from the word lo, the leaven. And Jesus speaks about the leaven of the Pharisees in Matthew, I think it's 17. He speaks about the doctrines of the leaven of the Pharisees. Now, Pharisee stems from two words. It means Pharaoh of the sea.
Right.
That has nothing to do with God. That has everything to do with the Lord God, which is the opposite of God. And that Jesus said that was the opposite in 1 Corinthians 6. He said, God has raised up the Lord God, so shall you raise us up by his own power.
Wait a minute. You're moving too fast.
Yeah, you're kind of like mom tonight. Slow it down.
Say that again. Say that one more time. Say that word in reference to the word Lord. Say that one more time.
In 1 Corinthians 6, Jesus said, God has raised up the Lord God, so shall he raise us up by his own power.
I got it.
When you go to the Constitution in Article 1, what's the first thing it says? It says you have vested your power into a thing called Congress. That word, the etymology on Congress, means with transgression. You have vested power and authority into the Lord God, your transgressor.
You're too advanced. You have to slow down.
It's called the Book of God. And it explains that these words are like Lord is dealing with the lords of England and so forth like that. We all can understand this right here, but we still sound like this Bible sounds like a contract. It doesn't sound like a book that we should be very attentive. It sounds like a contract book.
No, it's something that you should keep close by you. It's the blueprint.
Why would I keep a Think about what I'm saying, and Ms. Tami. This is the main book they use to brainwash people. Number one brainwashing book in the world. Yes,
exactly. And there's proof of it.
Go ahead.
Excuse me, gentlemen.
Go ahead, honey. Go ahead, Antoinette.
Miss Peppermint, will you be able to spend some extra time with us?
Absolutely. Jesus well, went off on
the... Can I make one announcement, please? I'm sorry, folks. We have 15 minutes left before we go into overtime. If you would like to continue with us on this conversation or to be a part of the conversation, please call in. The number is 718-508-9813. Again, that number is 718-508-9813. Thank you, and I'm sorry that we didn't get to the mind control, the targeted individuals, in detail, like was
this
the intentions, but we will get into it deeper, I promise.
What did you just
so thank
farm.
You, so
this
please
the
call
mind control.
Yes,
right.
Yes, it
mind
is.
I ain't mean to cut y'all, Miss Antoinette, but this is the farm control. This is the ultimate beast that's running all this shit.
It's mind control.
I hate to be trusting there, but I have to bring the truth.
Go ahead, Miss Tami. Finish what you were going to say.
We can sum it up and simplify it down to the smallest form. Jesus went off on the priest, which is the psychiatrist, the scribe, which is media, and the Pharisee, which is attorney. And he said, look, you're perverting God's word. You are the one that's changing all of these things. Now, when you study the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency, that is the production company. That is who manufactures these things. That is who trains these psychiatrists. If you go back to Nazi Germany, it wasn't a case of racism. Corporate governance came in. Their corporation came in 1928 into the world force and indemnified Poland. It said the Polish citizens were all on welfare, you know, they were sucking them dry, so they were going to kill them. And the world court said that was okay to do that, and that's what Nazi Germany was. That was an action of Congress. Congress has had now global governance since 1941 with the Atlantic Charter that Roosevelt and Winston Churchill entered into. On top of that, in 1942, they came in with the Master Lend-Lease Agreement that said we're going to lease this place. That is Malthusian theory.
That's real talk, man. You'll only understand that if you love history. If you don't love history, you'll have no idea what you're talking about.
No idea.
I got an idea.
No
basically
idea.
Saying we've been hit by a smooth criminal.
Absolutely.
Oh, why do you think he made the song? Man,
right.
He wasn't playing. You thought that was a joke? You thought that was music? He was
I'm talking about the people that's running this system. That's what I'm talking about. I ain't talking
same
about
concept. Same concept,
yeah.
Bro. He was letting you know. Smooth
yeah.
criminals.
Yeah. They
yeah, we
plan,
have two people with their hands up.
Hold on. Go ahead.
We have two people with questions.
Go ahead. Take some questions.
Okay. Erico 786. You have a question or comment?
All right,
hey,
you're
on
speaker.
All right, go to the next one. They don't. That's not ways we got. We got too much good information
okay.
going on.
Area code 404. Okay, I put you on. All right.
Now, can we get somebody?
That's
on
my
that?
Fault. 404.
Okay, no
that's me.
Wesley. Yes.
Yeah. I'm still.
Why
I'm with y'all, man. He's beautiful.
Yeah, yeah.
I like to chime in for a second.
Well, basically, she's saying she's talking about the Wizard of Oz, the motherfucker that's pulling the strings. That this beautiful girl is dancing.
Man, that's
beautiful.
How they do it. That's how they do it. I keep telling people, you can't even buy the Wizard of Oz. They don't even sell it. I've been trying to get it because I'm in all of this.
I'll give it to you because the Wizard of Oz was a very, that was about the whole thing, Toto. And
that was the whole lick right there. That was the whole lick.
Now, she had silver shoes in the book, but she had red in the movie, but silver was the one that
she
got
had,
to do the
exactly. And here's what I like to tell people. When they fell asleep in the field, guess where they were?
And some opium. Opium.
No,
opium.
Yes, that was the
that was opium
field.
Field.
They was high.
And
Walt Disney was up on it.
That was Frank Oz. Frank Oz was it was a guy named Frank who made that movie, who made the book in the movie. He was a great, and let me say, obviously, again, we're dealing with people who are into the occult. And
that's
they know
the world we live in. We live in the cult world, though.
I understand that. You understand that. Our show is pretty much trying to
separate ourselves from it.
No,
we can't. We have to learn it. We have to learn it, and then we can fight it.
Well, see,
right? We don't learn it, and that's what Tami was saying. All that stuff she was talking about, man, she could be on public television. And they would just throw her whole out the studio.
Right.
Here we go. Here we go with this nonsense.
Tami Peppermint is very well known. She's very well known. We are honored to have her.
That's not what I'm saying.
That's not what he's saying.
That's not what I'm saying.
Right. He's saying mainstream.
Oh, I'm sorry.
She's saying that if she was to go on mainstream TV like CNN,
thank you.
She would be cut off. She would be cut off.
Man, they'd laugh her off the damn
thing. Tami, have you been on mainstream TV?
No.
Let her finish her comment, please, gentlemen.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Tami.
I went up against Nancy Grace and Barbara Boxer and Diane Feinstein years ago, and I've been banned from even commenting on their site.
Exactly.
Well, Tami, you have too much information. You're exposing too much truth.
By translation, that means that she has information, and even though we wanted to bring you on the show, we really don't want to hear the truth. We just want to sensationalize it.
Well, can I make a suggestion to you, Tami? If you link up with Mud Deer from Cold Pink and Cynthia McKinney, y'all can snatch the sheet off all this Klan shit.
Oh, I would love that. Anytime, anywhere you need me, wherever we need to go, then that's where we need to go. We need to get this over and done with because I'm sick of this genocide. I'm tired of watching it. I'm tired of watching the suffering of humanity, all for the sake of corporate welfare with the first and second welfare theorem. Everything is written.
I can hear it in their voice, man. That's somebody crying out, man.
But everybody really, you know, the funny thing is, it's strange that no one, all of us should be crying out, really.
But we're not, brother. They're begged to be asked the question. How can we not all crying out right now?
You're crying out, but it's just that we're not able to perpetrate it all to other people. You actually
That's why you're on your show,
man.
You know what? And I'm gonna tell you something. I really believe in. We gotta start dying for this, okay? And I'm not a proponent of suicide bombing or. Please, I'm not trying to end my life. I'm not trying to do that.
I told y'all how to do this, man.
Wait a minute. One at a time, gentlemen. Please.
Let me finish what I'm saying. I'm 52 years of age. I see where this is going. And I know it's going to get better. However, I've come to the realization that it's not going to happen in my lifetime.
Well, it's
not going to happen.
Hold on. Let Tami respond,
Tami.
Please.
Go ahead, Tami.
Go ahead, Tami.
When we won this case, and it's so imperative for everybody to realize, we came in as the United States lowercase. That United States in rem, which means against the thing, cannot be named as the thing at all, which means incorporated into libertas, which means liberty. Liberty can only be granted within honor. We came in otherwise known as the word that is I am. The United States of being is I am. And when we see them, we declare them because they're fictional entities. None of them have life. And a psychopath is not the human race. They are perpetrating genocide against the human race. So what we did was we wrapped the millstone around their neck, just like Jesus taught us to do.
No, but the way to do this, I'm going to tell you how to do this, all right? This paradigm and the shift, we're getting ready to open up this portal. The way we're going to have to do it It's all us that's knowledgeable. Let the people know, and I'm telling y'all, with this, y'all remember of the Pan-African Intelligence Network. So if we want to change this, all we got to do is pick a particular time and all us think about tearing down these towers of Babylon with our mind at one time. We just start meditating on this system crumbling within with our mind. We have the power, y'all. That's the only way to do it. Not no power.
Not coming.
We can do this.
One at a time.
Well, let me finish my statement, please. Oh, this is crucial. This is crucial. This is crucial.
Okay.
This is crucial. The way to defeat this, I'm 56 years old, okay? And I'm getting information fed to me daily that with this new conscious shift, we will start being able to do this with our mind, with our collective mind, to start shaking the system of Babylon and these towers, and the message and the polarity will shift. All we got to do is like 12 o'clock on a Friday or something, everybody that's got knowledge and the power of the brain, we kick in with our brain waves and start meditating on this evil system of corruption, of crumbling.
Now, hold on. Mm-hmm. Tami, what do you think about what you're just saying? What is that comment on what you just said, Ms. Tami?
That is the truth. The thing is that we just maintain it that we are all members of the body of Christ.
There you
that
go.
That means we are all members. We are all the same body. We are the United States of Being, otherwise known as I Am. When you look at their conceptual words such as gender, when you're claiming to be a male or a female, even just male or female, like Adam and Eve, you're claiming to be a different race. That's a concept that they sold you. When you go back to the Greek interpretation of the Bible, Wycliffe's version, it says you took on concepts. God took the concept of night and day. God took the concept of light and dark. God took the concept of water and dirt and earth. These are all concepts that were given to you by the Lord God. And Jesus told somebody, he said, divest yourself of all that possesses you. Jesus said, divest yourself of all that possesses you. All of these titles, male, female, doctor, teacher, boy, girl, mom, dad, all of these things, they all know those concepts. Those are psychological concepts.
So now that like I said, when this evil prevail, and if, like the God say, when God hear everybody wailing at the same time of this agony of this evil system, that's when y'all will realize what I'm talking about, when we all a member of this Pan-African Intelligence Network with our minds, okay? With this telepathy, we can do this with our mind. That's what's going to happen with this new awakening. I'm telling y'all, that's what's going to happen. Y'all in it, whether y'all know it or not, we all gonna do this together.
Okay, understand. We want to get Ms. Tami more time on here, but you're right. I'm not saying that's not impossible possibility, but since she's been dealing with the court
Tami, I understand that you won against the Congress for human trafficking.
Absolutely, as well as genocide.
That is outstanding. I truly commend you for that, because that is such a burden on, even for people that don't have family members that are taken, but the ones that do, and the children and the babies, I commend you for fighting that.
But human trafficking, now let me get this right. Did you get now most people going to think of it as a reparation. Did you get a reparation from this? Or, I mean, what would be the benefit
just not,
right now?
Right now, it's just not coming down. What had happened is Congress told the House of Lords that they were going to protect humanity over here, and then they got global governance in 1941. So the United States is across the globe. What had happened was, instead of facilitating that contract with the Treasury, which is where they get those funds from, they had been preying on us since 1777. We evidenced this on court record. We just now got the order where they forfeited the Treasury, and we're just now setting up our bank, because they had taken over everything and perverted everything, and now we're just now fixing that, and everything's falling into place.
Is there another gentleman with you? He said he has the keys. Is that the same gentleman that you with?
I don't think so. It was with the judge in our case is Kurt Martin. He has a show called Bo and Rocco on Revolution Radio. He speaks about this last week, Wednesday. He read that final order. And I can read that if you'd like as soon as we come back here in a few minutes on the other number.
Okay.
I'd like to comment on something that she said.
Go ahead.
When she had talked about the previous subject matter when things are taken away from you, and we were talking about reparations and all of that, the key word that she mentioned in the very front of that whole dissertation that she gave was tribunal. How many people understand what tribunal means?
Right, and it goes all the way back to the Sestri case law.
But wait a minute. I want the listeners, not her. I know she knows what it means.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I want the listeners to chime in. What is a tribunal? What does a tribunal mean?
Excuse me, N2K.
She's going to tell it now. Let her tell it
now. N2K, keep in mind that Tami Peppermint is my special guest tonight.
Oh, I know.
Okay. Yeah, so,
and
you know.
And this is not a question for her, because I already know she knows what a tribunal is, which was in the first three sentences of what she was giving you out of the Black Law Dictionary. Now I want to know is, who's listening enough to can pick out that word, because that word will define everything that's said. What does tribunal mean?
Could I pick it back? I mean, I don't like to say that word, because I know my brother what he just said. What he said is, it's biblical time, and where I'm coming from the tribe of Judah, okay? That's what I'm bringing y'all, the message from the tribe of Judah. I'm here to roar and tell y'all what's happening. So, Miss Tammy or whatever, Antoinette, that's all Big West got to say. Bleep, bleep, bleep. That's all, folks.
Right.
Tammy, what do you think about the, what they just said? I mean, I'm giving you the time to share because, you know, you're talking to everybody, not just four on the phone. You're talking to everybody.
Right.
What are you saying to that?
Tribunal actually stems from the word for embankment or bank. And in the original sense, that was us holding each other and protecting each other, holding and keeping humanity. Now, if you go back into the Greek mythology of the river Styx, all of these vessels are floating on this river as lost souls. Well, in 1864, for example, Congress came in with the Geneva Convention and maintained foundling hospitals to find lost souls as prisoners of war. That's who's picking you up, because you have no idea who you are. You are lost at sea. You are lost in the lost souls, the river of lost souls. You are claiming something else to be your father. You're patronizing a fiction.
Like they got us at straw, man.
Hold up.
N2K. Let him finish his statement before you talk over him, okay?
All
thank
right.
Thank you.
All right.
I'm good. Thank you. Brother Driver. Okay, I'm sorry. Tami.
No, she was saying what she was just saying, but I'm letting her roll because she's giving out so much information. I hope everybody is listening. Those of us on the phone who knows, then it's not really about you getting you take it. We try to teach others. That's what we're doing tonight, and that's what I'm always telling people we should be doing. I mean, the debate that we already know, that's proof that we know a lot of this what we're talking about because we're able to have a conversation with her and a logical one at that. All we're trying to do is get her to tell as much as she can so others can hear who's listening on the lines as well. So let me ask you another question in dealing with that. What about these nations that, let's just say, are not viable into the Bible? India, how do you see the humanity coming together since you use universal? How's that going to work with these other groups of people?
I just told you, I just told you how to come in together, man.
No. I'm talking about from a practical. Yeah, everybody's not going to do what you said, man, at 12 o'clock. Other than if we can't.
It's not going to be particularly at 12 o'clock, man. It's going to be all collective.
But I'm saying, okay, until that happens, I want to know how she feel, not you, how she feel about connecting these groups that don't read the Bible.
I've been doing this for about 13 years now, almost 14 years now. We've been in India for about the last 8 years with our advocacy. We've been teaching this as well. And when you go back to the foundational text, which are the Homeric hymns, that's where the Sikh Bible text comes from. That's where the Quran comes from. That's where the Bible comes from. That's where everything comes
from. Uh-huh.
And so we all have the same voice. We just have different interpretations thanks to these priests. Those psychologists or psychiatrists have perverted the word of God and taught you what these Bibles say or what these texts say, when in reality, that is not what it says. Jesus kept saying over and over and over again in Matthew, the walk of his walk through Matthew is one of my favorites besides his walk through Corinth. But he's sitting there and he's telling you, you know not the scripture of God. Well, when you go back to that word, that means walk. That's the walk of God. Now, in this society, we can be prescribed, subscribed, superscribed, inscribed, and all of these other writings that are not the scripture of God.
Mm-hmm.
Those are not the walk of God. And so we're acting and behaving as fictions, and that's how we're lost at sea. We don't know who we are. Nobody knows who they are. They're not standing as God. They're not saying, excuse me, Congress, but you've been human trafficking. This is the action of genocide, and I will evidence it by your works and action, which are congressional acts. In the Constitution, they have redefined us as birds. They called us terns. They said we migrated here and were imported. Well, then they imparted to us the Preservation Act under 16 U.S.C. 7. That's if they can kill us anytime they want to.
Well, what about the Bible? Let's give a positive. Does the Bible say it's going to be a year of jubilee? Give some information on that, because it says like all will be forgiven. It will like be charged off. Is that what jubilee means in that particular segment of the Bible?
No. And Jesus said specifically in Matthew, he said, for those that harm children, be it better that you have a millstone hung around your neck and you be tossed into the sea of commerce. He said, forgive those who owe you things like money. But he did not say to forgive harm upon a human being. Jesus walked with compassionate justice, and he maintained that we are to remove all harm from the ability of harm. So if somebody's raping me, and this is what makes me the most angry, is this court process. If I am raped right now, the court or the bank will charge my rapist rent on my body. If my child is raped today and somebody preys on my child, the court will charge that predator rent on a child's body, and they will cash in on everything that happens to us, and that goes back to the birth certificate. That document, the birth
record. Can you explain that?
The birth record is actually implicating.
No, I don't mean that. I mean how the court is going to charge a rapist rent.
That's what it does every day. It charges a rapist rent on my body. The court is the one that fines them. They collect the fees.
And then they get money off your birth certificate for you being there.
Incarcerated. Right. When you're born, and that means thrown, by the way, when you're thrown into this world and you come out of the birth water of your mother, you come down a birth canal. France owns all the water in the world, and this is where Malthusian's theory comes in. That female has been in shadow since the coronation charter, when the king took her estate. They own those birth waters, the birth canal. Then it docks the child onto their land. At that time, that child is diagnosed as to the action of bottomry. That's a bottomry bond. Now, when your diagnosis is born, that goes through the ICD-10. That's the International Classifications of Diseases and Disorders. So you can be born breech and you have a diagnosis. What that is bottomry requires that, first of all, you have the birth record where the seal of the vessel is sealed by the state seal. That's where the foot of the slave is sealed. That makes the baby a slave. That's the keel of the vessel. That says they found the vessel on the sea.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Because when the baby's born in the hospital, what do they call it? The delivery room. That means the baby's been just delivered to the state. That's why they call it the delivery room.
And that's in a library in season. And that's a form of mortgage. Now, when you sign a mortgage, mortgage means a dead pledge.
Yeah,
you
that's
are
right.
Right. Dead. And that's one of the most horrifying things. When you name that child, I'll read you from the definition in Black Law Dictionary from name, N-A-A-M, the attaching or taking of movable goods and chattels called this or mort, according as the chattels were living or dead. Now, you're dead the minute you take on a fictional last name. The definition of name in N-A-M, in Old English law, a distress or seizure of chattels. As a Latin conjunction for, because often used by the old writers in introducing the quotation of a Latin maxim, namere, in old records, to take, seize, or distrain. You are stolen by claiming a need. That is how we're taken. That is human trafficking.
The well, they've been human trafficking for a long time, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Too long. Yeah.
To the CMS.gov. You can go to CMS.gov right now, which is the Centers for Medicaid Services, Medicare and Medicaid. That's who's diagnosing you. That's who's cashing in on your diagnosis. And it doesn't just go from the birth bond. Throughout your life, your diagnosis is injured. That word injure means to bring into law, injure. The
right.
The court has to talk every aspect of your life. They're casting them on your existence, upwards in the amount of $33 billion. Those things lay in 16 tranches. They're guaranteed and insured at $2 billion each.
Has anybody been awarded that amount of money?
No, we just facilitated it. Like I said, the last order went out on October 28th, just now, but the last service went out on, I think it was November 7th.
No, but I'm saying not just you, because I'm going to be honest with you. There's a lot of people, a lot of the Moors, Yaffa Bay. I mean, I can name a huge amount of people, Rod Class. They're very versed in the same thing you're talking about. And it seems like an army of people should get together, especially you guys who went into battle, into
well,
these courts.
Well, what happened with Rod Class is I went down there to see him. I went to North Carolina, and Rod Class and I got together. And I talked to him about coming in as a sovereign state under 28 U.S.C. 97. He continues to be a D.C. citizen. He's got a certificate that says he's a private attorney general or whatever crap.
Right, that's what he has.
Right, that's an office. Okay, when he won his first administrative ruling, Congress came in against him and said a citizen cannot sue a foreign state under the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act. Okay, so I told Rod Class this. He doesn't listen. He's still coming in as a citizen. As a citizen, you're always a subject to them. A citizen is the rest. That's the thing.
So how is she coming in at? How should he do it?
He should come in as a sovereign state. And I told him this over and over and over again, but he doesn't want to hear me. He has
but
to
then,
have
okay,
that.
Okay. Yeah, because I know he said that. Now, let's take into it, because we got you here. You have the Moors. Who says that they're sovereign. They got the same, matter of fact, they say that the five civilized tribes of America was already here, that they say the Iroquois Confederation is a true government, the Zodiac, the Constitution. How do you tie all that in? Because it still come out the Bible.
Right, because they're claiming to be citizens. They're actually claiming to be sovereign citizens. When you take up a title or enter into a treaty with another bank, you're claiming to be a citizen. You don't have
any. Well, let me ask you a question. Are you familiar with the first president of the United States called John Hanson? And he was a black man. You familiar with him?
I've heard of him in the past. It's been years, though.
And you look at y'all look at a $2 bill, and you will see. John Hanson sitting on the $2 bill. He's a black man, John Hanson, the first president of the United States.
But he would be a Moor to some people. It would say because they gave him the Treaty of Friendship and Peace. Because remember, they're supposed to be the ones that recognize this so-called government so it can act, so it can have life. So that's why I'm trying to get all this in together, because, see, I think all our minds need to sit down like think tanks, because you have so many people, like you said, you told him one way. Now, he probably not going to listen, this is my opinion, until he see you win, and then he might shake and say, and that's the thing, that be human nature. Somebody got to win it before I say, oh, you was right. And so that
and
seems to be the case.
That is so sad, because Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. Whoever saves his life shall lose it. Don't wait till the last minute to jump on board.
Yeah.
You know, you need to patronize yourself. And all that I'm teaching, I'm not saying follow me. I need everybody to take up their own authority. We came in as sovereign states of being, not citizens, not subjects, no longer being considered matter, because that's what you're considered in the court process. Subjected matter is you. They're referring to you as matter, just form. They view us as garbage.
Right.
They don't see you as a being. I mean,
we're monsters. We're monsters in Black Law Dictionary.
And not just that, in the first and second welfare theorem, they call our children pollution. In Black Law Dictionary, when you go into court on any issue, that refers to a child. In real estate law, issue means child. You're putting issues before the court. You're allowing nothing to trick your children out. You can't subject their jurisdiction. Don't submit. Don't subject yourself. And stop underwriting policy. When you are subscribing to the system, you're actually considered the underwriter. If you look at the definition of Lloyd's of London, you are the underwriter maintaining this whole thing, because you're saying, yay, yay, give it to me. I love you, Daddy. I love you, Daddy. Stop doing that and take up your own authority. That's what Jesus kept saying. Know thyself. Know thyself.
Know thyself is true, and I agree, because the Mayat, which is the principle that we were talking about the other day, but and we're talking with a large ignorance is in this land right now, huge ignorance, because on one hand, it's easy. First of all, me and Wes and all of us can say, yeah, about the president stuff, you know, when did the real president come into play? When did that happen? My question would be, if we go in as, like you say, sovereign, we should go in as sovereign state?
State of being. You're just a sovereign state of
being. Did you do this with paperwork, or you did it with verbs, with orally? Was this paperwork done or orally done?
We went through the whole process. We had to overrule their judge because he came in and he admitted that he was human trafficking, said there's a proper way and an improper way to human traffic. So eventually we had to overrule him, and we said, excuse me, but you just admitted that you're a freaking criminal. And that's how we won. That judge, those judges have taken an oath under 28 U.S.C. subsection 453 to discharge congressional bankers.
Now, what happened to the judge? Did he get disbarred or anything happened?
No, because they're declared dead, the CIA comes in and does the production and everything, and you're not now in the mainstream media. Prior to this case, an attorney was not a natural person, as defined by the 14th Amendment. They were all banks or parts of a bank under 12 U.S.C. 773. Now, prior to this, they could only be sanctioned by court process, slapped on the hand. They could not be charged as the surety. Now, since we ordered that they are the surety, and we maintained the agreed entry with Northern Holdings and Trust back in May, now they're being charged. Just recently, you can see this, one of the attorneys, they shot him 2 times in the legs, and they said now that he's a serial bank robber. There was one this week, an attorney was charged with robbing a gas station that he, those things didn't happen, but that's how they're born. The same way that we were born injured or brought into law, that's how they're being born now. They are the new infants under the laws of infants. They are the surety. Only a natural person could be a surety.
Uh-huh. Well, I understand, and believe me, I've heard this, and it makes a lot of sense when you sit down, because the words are what the definitions of this, and not Webster's definition, but that definition in two law books, Bouvier and Blacks, is totally unreal if anybody who doesn't have it. please get it. You will find yourself saying, my goodness, I had no idea that that word meant that. So that is fascinating. Now, what you see for the future now? What are you going to, and we should all jump in, what can we all do to get involved with what you're doing?
It'll all be over soon. You just have to you have to put your intent on record. And in my process, there's the forgiveness doc and then the executor doc, because you have to obliterate the franchise first and then come in as the executor. And all it is you're saying, I am the authority. I am under my house. Your last name is your house. I am under your house. I'm not in the House of Representatives. I'm not a citizen. I am the authority, but your intent has to be made known. The attorney, since 1938 with Dr. Jesus, has taken your word off the court record. There's no evidence. There's testimony, and there's hearsay, and there's all these things, preponderance of evidence, with the Uniform Commercial Code Act, UCC Act. They came in and created a word called fact. A fact can be an allegation repeated more often than once. That is not evidence. They've taken your word and kept it off a court record for a reason. Because if your intent, your word is made known, that's when it stops. Because the fiction does not supersede God. A fiction does not supersede reality.
Now, how often do sovereign people who claim sovereignty win in court?
Well, we won, but you cannot claim to be a sovereign citizen. That there's no such thing as a sovereign citizen. Out of Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, under the definition of citizen, all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. That says you're always a subject. Don't claim to be a citizen. Don't claim to be a resident. And stop using that last name. If you go to 18 U.S.C., subsection 1342, you will realize what I'm saying. They're charging you as a felon. That's how they're keeping you in the chute. You're posting your own bond by accepting mail through the Postal Service. That stems from the Treaty of Amity.
Well, I suppose I'm charged with a crime. And how do I, in this particular court system, get myself either acquitted or get myself freed from the charges?
You have to indict them, because what they're doing is that you really haven't committed a crime. They're charging people under 27 CFR 72.11. Those are all commercial crimes. And if you look at the definition, it says those are crimes against the revenue laws. That means that if you go out and, like, rob a bank, they're telling you that you're violating a bank, which is a fiction. You can't do that. That's not a harm against a human being. That's a commercial crime. They're charging people for using marijuana. That's saying you're undercutting the federal government. If you're violating a commercial crime or the
okay,
law...
Okay, so my question again is, how does somebody win?
You have to come in and make them... first of all, you want to come in on an equitable estoppel. Equitable estoppel says somebody brought you into court based on false or fraudulent pretenses. And you need to go study just the... definition. I like the definition out of Black's Eighth, I think, for equitable estoppel. But what that says is, hey, no, you don't have jurisdiction over me because somebody's already perpetrated a fraud. I'm not coming in. And do not answer a summons. They have taught us that witchcraft is something else. You can only summon the dead. If you answer a summons, you're saying you are dead.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you something, because who would just ask that question? Who asked that question? Who just asked that?
I don't know. I really don't know. I'm sorry.
I was Joe.
Okay, Joe, good question, because I was thinking the same thing. If you don't go, say, for instance, and I've heard this before, don't go. They come to your house. You do know they come to your house.
No,
that's
not
a warrant. They put a bitch warrant on you, won't you, if you don't go.
I have seen people who were supposed to be in court.
If you don't answer a summons, they're gonna put out a bench warrant on you. Let's say, for example, you're
okay,
a parent.
Okay, one at a time, though. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Just let me finish this part. Now you can talk, Joey. I've seen them come after people with the either the sheriff or a homicide detective come to your house, and you don't go. And I'm telling you, the law seems to work different with different peoples too. I mean, that's another thing we have to discuss.
Right, right.
I'm just going to be honest. I know what you're saying is 100% true, but it seems that when it comes down to being applied by certain, like Wesley Snipes should never have went to jail at all.
No, absolutely not. And he went. We have a site. It's called ChooseYourSide.org. I have hundreds of...
ChooseYourSide.org. Choose your side. Okay, I got you.
Okay, got you.
And we have, hundreds of hours of audio. But one of the most important audios is on YouTube. It's called Adventures with Tami. If you go to my YouTube channel, it's TammyK32. If you go there and find Adventures with Tami, you'll see what I'm talking about. Now, in our process, you come in on the forgiveness and you obliterate that franchise. You're not saying, well, please help me, please let me do this. You're not asking for their authority. Then you come in as the executor, okay? If they try to administer your estate after that, they are guilty of executor based on tort. Now, we also have the ordinance of the estate, which maintains that you are the United States, your children are the United States. Okay, these things are legislated by witness quorum. When you put that on court record, as well as the fee schedule, you send it to the entity that could possibly coming up against you because you're contracting with them at that point. You send them the contract and you say, look, for all of these years, you have been mistaking me. You've been taking me thinking that I'm lost. You are privateers. You are given letter of marque to go out and attack and capture enemy vessels and bring them in front of admiralty courts for condemnation and sale. Now, if you would like to contract with me further, go ahead and arrest me. My fees start at $33 billion because that is what you are making off of.
Well, you're better than Ron. Ron's cheaper than you. Ron tells him $1,000 a minute.
Again, I still want to know how you're going to win in court.
Well, that's what happened. So we have put this into play. That YouTube video called Adventures with Tami, Ryan and Adam were stopped in Illinois, in southern Illinois. Now, Ryan had a warrant. Adam had a warrant out for his arrest prior to him doing the documents, the cops did stop them. It was the state patrol. The guy they were with was driving 100 miles an hour, which I don't agree with. But anyway, so he had a suspended license. Now, that guy was a citizen, and he was traveling with sovereign states, with their executor forgiveness ordinance of the estates and fee schedules on record. Now, it took about 45 minutes for the cops to locate the corporate counsel and talk to the attorneys in charge, which we recommend. Don't talk to cops. Cops are required to have low IQs so that they can be puppeted by these attorneys. The attorneys tell them what to do. And they're not... bad guys, they're directed by corporate counsel to do these things against you. They're directed to kill us. They're directed to harm us. They're directed to injure us. So what you want to do is you hand them the ordinance of this state, and you say you need to contact your supervisor. Now, that particular time, it took about 45 minutes. Cops come back and let them go. Done deal. They cannot arrest a sovereign state. As long as you have not harmed a human being, they cannot arrest you because you have committed no crime whatsoever. Commercial crime is the action of privateering. That is what cops do. They are privateers.
Okay, let's say I'm charged with theft, or let's say I'm charged with being a person who hasn't paid child support for a while. How do I beat the court at those two particular instances?
Good question.
Yes.
Two different aspects. So you have the theft charge, which is, of course, a commercial crime under 27 CFR 72.11. You have not harmed a human being, period. So you come in with the equitable estoppel. Now, as for child support, that's actually a civil agency, nothing to do with court, and they have lost their funding. Again, it's equitable estoppel by election. You're telling them, look, you have given me two options. I'm taking the third option. I am not under your jurisdiction, and the action of criminal coercion is threatening to charge me with a crime unless I pay you money. That is extortion.
Okay, let me ask you another question. There's a case that was in Georgia about a couple of months ago. Some people that looked like me, they was a religion of a Hebrew Israelites, and what they was doing, they was finding, like, foreclosed houses and just squatting in the houses under a sovereign state, and they end up getting in trouble. So how should they want to go about that, say, if you want to go ahead?
Because they were claiming to be citizens. Now, under the doctrine of election, says that you can elect to have a right or a benefit, but never both. But you're never the heir. You can't elect anything. If you're a sovereign state, you're not claiming rights. You're not claiming benefits. You're claiming your inheritance. And you're saying, look, you're an interpleader. You've come in abatement of a freehold. That's unlawful on its face. Probate court is unlawful on its face.
All right, again, before Wesley answered, started that, I wanted to find out again, all right, how to win in court, not to find out the definitions. I want to find out what would happen if you are charged with being a person who hasn't kept up with your child support payments, or you've been charged with a felony. Again, you just stopped at, that's extortion. I agree with you. Now what happens from there in order to make sure that the person is going to claim to be a sovereign state or whatever he or she is going to claim to be, how are they going to free themselves from this particular type of judicial process?
Under 28 U.S.C. 97, which is the Foreign Sovereign Immunities Act, you would take that up into district court and sue the foreign state as a sovereign state because that foreign state is facilitating the action of extortion.
All right, so you're suggesting to sue them, but before you do that, you're already in prison.
See, that's the part that I'm having. Let's deal with a little bit of reality, because what you're saying is accurate in definition in terms, but when we get arrested, and you even tell a person there's no harm, no foul done, you know, I didn't hurt nobody, you can write your own affidavit. I'm witness this person.
Well,
And they'll start to laugh. They won't even act like you are making sense. And by the time you realize, you go, and now most, I'm looking at it as a perspective, not somebody who knows as much as you do, but people who this happens to, just a little bit, say they heard a little bit about what we're talking about, and they'll try to do some of this.
You don't want to commingle anything. First of all, when you go back to the Charter of Forests and Chases, which is what we're under, you're an animal in their force. They're claiming that we're just all vermin and animals in their force. Affi, the word affiant, means it's, and I'm sorry to use foul language here, but it basically means shit in a force. It means
that's
it's fun. Just fun. So when you're facilitating affidavits or anything else, you're actually not speaking anything. What speaks is evidence. So instead of affidavits, you want to use that admission statement, which admits evidence on the court record. So if you have evidence, say you have a letter from child support enforcement that says if you don't pay this, we're going to arrest you, you put that letter on as evidence. Only a judge can see evidence. Now, a trier of fact can see affidavits and testimony, but a trier of fact is not a judge bound by judicial canon. A trier of fact is an attorney in a black dress. You see the difference in the administrative
court?
Still not answering my question. I'm charged with a crime, okay? That's mistaken identity. I'm charged with having robbed some sort of store. They've got me in handcuffs. I want to know how to make sure that I don't go to jail, that I don't have to spend money on a lawyer, that I don't have to spend any time at all within the judicial system. Is that possible?
Yes, if you follow the process. Now, if you have the opportunity, you have to get your evidence on court records. You don't need an attorney. An attorney is Satan. To attorney means to pay homage to another Lord God. That thing doesn't have allegiance to you.
Yeah, we understand that.
Can you just give me the step-by-step process? Make it simple.
Well, you will want to admit onto evidence that you have not committed a harm against a human being, which is the definition of a crime.
Okay.
Now, commercial crimes are defined in their law under 27.
Look, Tami, what I'm asking is this. I'm in handcuffs. I don't have time for definitions, neither do the cops, neither do the judges. I want to find out. They've got me in handcuffs. I want to get out of jail to the suite, okay? I don't want to have to say to them, you know, the definition of tribunal is such. I want to say, I'm out. I want to spend 15 minutes in front of a judge or in front of somebody and get out. Well, how do I do it?
Right. And that never happens in our process. As long as you have your documents on record, the forgiveness doc, the executor doc, your fee schedule, and your ordinance of this state, they cannot arrest you because your risk is too great.
I'm already arrested, though. You're telling me they can't arrest me, but a lot of people get arrested, regardless of what their particular judicial philosophy is, all right?
Not when you have your documents legislated and on record, and that's the requirement. If you have your documents legislated, that is law. Those are not argued. And then you send those to any entity or wherever you're going to be. Personally, we send our ordinances out to the local county, the local city. Wherever you travel, you send your documents there first.
Yeah, I haven't done that. I've been mistaken. Remember, I got a mistaken identity. I'm already in handcuffs. What do I do?
Right. So at that point in time, you're going to have to really work hard at it, I guess, because you have to.
I guess so.
You have to use your intent, and that's our process.
All right, so prior to that is what you're talking about, something about getting my documents registered or recognized, okay.
Not registered, you're just recording your intent on public records. You're maintaining as a sovereign state on public records. You carry those docs with you. When they attempt to arrest you, you hand them your ordinance of the state. And I urge you to go to my YouTube channel and listen to Adventures with Tami.
I'm going to go to your site, chooseyourside.org, right?
Right. And to my YouTube channel, Adventures with Tami. That's when Ryan and Adam were stopped by the cops. You can hear the conversation. It lasted about 45 minutes altogether.
Mm-hmm.
And in it, they were let go. But they both had warrants for their arrest prior to that for commercial crimes. However, they had their documents on record. They had their fee schedule sent to all law enforcement. The law enforcement was made aware of the contract, which is what the fee is. And if they attempt on you, they do owe you $33 billion, and they were let go. They do not want the liability.
Okay, so how does a person go through the process of getting these particular types of documents?
Please listen to all of my audios. It takes a long time to realize who you are, what they've done against you, how they perpetrated these crimes, what a privateer is, how they steal you, and what they need to do to find your own authority.
Well, I don't mind getting a lesson, but still, I like to know how to do it, you know, in a day.
Right. And
can't do everything in a day, Joe.
Why can't you do it in a day? Why can't you get the documents done in a day?
Because I don't...
But you're in America, not in China, man.
Right, and that's the thing that we don't do. We don't sell a religion. I'm not selling you a government. I'm not saying patronize me. I'm saying patronize you. And to do that, you have to realize who you are, and it takes a while. This society is now maintained by me, 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 gimme, now, today, today, today. Nobody thinks about tomorrow. Nobody wants to exert an effort.
So how long would it take, though?
That's called
Joe, it requires you to study. It requires you to study and to know it.
She has an organization, right? And the organization is supposed to help. Okay, so I don't want to have to go through 3 years of study in order to get my documents approved.
The bottom line, it still comes down to you. When you understand it well enough where you can teach it to someone else, then you
That's
basically
the answer,
know
Antoinette.
You're ready.
The answer is, if I want
okay,
these particular
documents... Okay, I'm sorry.
Documents,
Tami, can you answer him?
Well, human needs to follow society. Everybody's been taught just impulse and to act quickly and don't learn anything because there's always that government there that'll help you out, right? You can patronize something else, and they'll give you welfare benefits, and they'll give you Social Security. They'll also give you a nice jail bag, and they'll give you a nice desk when you're not producing. They'll also cut your head right off, won't they? So you can either put
it
in
your time. Wait a minute, let her finish, please.
You can put in a set time to study and learn yourself and your authority, or you can go with the other daddy. Those are the two options that you have. There's not a third
option. So I go to your, okay, I go to your audio or I go to your YouTube, and you're explaining how to do it. So after I learn how to do it, how long will it take for me to get these particular documents you're talking about?
You actually, I write your words. So that's your intent spoken. Those documents, once you realize what they say, this is my authority. This is me. This
right.
is my contract. This is my contract. If you want to contract with me and take me anywhere, that's fine with me. I'm good to go with that, but you're going to pay me for that service.
Okay, so how long will it take and how much will it cost?
It doesn't cost anything, and it depends on how long, how much effort you put in per day to learn about yourself.
Okay.
Okay.
Can I ask you a question, Tami?
Uh-huh.
Okay, you all know that justice is unequal, right? So my scenario is the way to shut down this unequal racist court system is for anybody that's charged with a crime to not plead guilty and make these fuckers take you to court. That'll shut down all this. Don't nobody cop a plea. That'll shut down this damn justice system because they can't won't have time to put everybody, give everybody a trial. What do you think about that?
The game of risk is the game of insurance. And remember when we were talking about the birth record and the diagnosis? When they arrest you or charge you with a crime, they're diagnosing you with something, and they're cashing in on that. So you need to stand from above them and indict them for doing those things rather than going into court. If you go into court, they're making money on every day. When an attorney comes in with interest, that means he has interest in your body. It's like a poker game. He just threw money in the pot. And he's saying, I know I can win this case, or I know you can win this case because I'm going to play it like this. It depends on the amount of revenue they want to derive off of your body. Remember, this is human trafficking. And it's all a game of chess and risk. Insurance is risk. Insurance is wrapping around the court system. The top level of the government is actually in broadcasting, the Broadcasting Board of Governors. The level below that is insurance. And the level
so you're saying anybody charged
Wait a minute,
with a crime...
Wesley, let her finish, please. Wesley, let her finish her statement, please.
I'm sorry, Tami. Forgot
the
that women take a long time to explain.
Okay, let her finish, though.
The media is the main, is the top part of government. Insurance is the second level. Courts are the third level. So whatever you do, if you create an action or if you allow an action to come upon you, they're cashing in on the insurance aspect. So you don't want to do that. You want to stand above them, above the media, because as a sovereign state, you're above that. You're not subscribing. You're not submitting. You're not subjecting yourself to their authority. And you can't do that because they cash in every time you do that. If you patronize it, and that's part of it. Remember when she in the garden, when you partook of the tree of knowledge, partake means participate. When
mm-hmm.
you participate in this game, then they're cashing in on your body. If you stand above it and you indict them and you charge them under 46 U.S.C. Chapter 311 and 313, because within maritime law, if somebody comes up against you with charges under acts of commerce and private acts and you catch them, they're volunteering to assume the charge. That is the game of risk. That's why risk is there. The insurance industry is there. Because there's a backhand risk associated, they can always get caught, and that stems from the Commerce Clause of the Constitution. That's how the game exists. If they couldn't
so
get
basically
caught,
to simplify, see, you got to simplify. I agree with Joe. You got to simplify. So basically, if you're charged with a crime, just don't fucking go up and show the court when you get out. That's basically to simplify, right?
Well, we need your documents. When you put your documents on record, you're legislating them as law, and then you send them to that local municipality. So if you get something in the mail tomorrow, you send it back, unacceptable mail as per 18 U.S.C. 1342. That means that you're not a felon. When you send that back, you want a copy of it, copy it outside of the envelope, and then you send that court or whoever sent you that document your document, your forgiveness document, your executor document, and your ordinance of the estate and your fee schedule. You let them know, if you want to contract with me further, that's great. These are my fees. Now, are you sure you want to play this game? because it's really expensive now for you to come out and attack and capture this vessel. Now that I know what the game is, I know your number, and I was able to open the book. And that's what Revelation says. When you're able to open the book, then your wrath is made known. You are to hold them accountable. You are not to be submitting. You are not to be running from them or hiding your head in the sand. You just hand them your fee schedule along with your forgiveness doc, and you tell them, if you would like to contract with me further, here you go. I'm all yours. Starting season 33 books.
Now, Tami, do you go after them as individuals, or are you going after the state? Are you going after each one of them's bond that they have on their cells? Are you going against, like, the whole police force or the whole county?
Well, we went after Congress and their original charters, because these unlawful acts are actually in their act and in their original charters. So we put those on evidence, and we said, look, this is how you're human trafficking. If you go back to the Treaty of Amity Commerce and Navigation, for example, that's when they posted you by mail to discharge congressional bankruptcy. So every time you take something out of the mailbox, you're posting your own bond by subscribing to that last name. You're being charged as a felon under 18 U.S.C. 1342. Now, when you stop this cycle and you say, excuse me, that's a criminal act on its face, then they're held accountable. But if you continue to let them get away with it, they're never held accountable. And that's what the resurrection means. Resurrection doesn't mean somebody's going to come back from the dead. Reincarnate means they're coming back from the dead. Resurrection means you're going to be able to stand again. When you start standing and you hold them accountable for what they've done upon you, that's when this ends. That's the apocalypse. That's revelation, because you're revealing them and revealing yourself at the same time by the evidence.
Yes.
Antoinette, I'm so sorry, but is Drybone still on the line? Because I got a feeling he dropped off because he just tried to call me. And if he's dropped off, I'm willing to get off your line so you can catch.
Oh, yes. Well, you know what? I'm getting ready to end the call because we only have 15 minutes.
Okay.
And there's times, unfortunately, that BTR will drop us before it's time. And so, Tami, I truly want to thank you so much for being here.
I love you so much, and I'm so glad that you had me tonight. You are so beautiful. Everybody's been beautiful tonight. I love this energy.
Oh, and Tami, we would love to have you back.
Anytime. I would love it.
I'll get in contact with Nisi, and, you know, we can, you know, figure out a day that would be good for you. You know, because we come on every... Pardon me?
I'm not on this Saturday. This Saturday, Kat has a show on Studio A over at Revolution Radio, so I took a spot with her. But next Thursday, between 6 and 8 p.m. Eastern, come on, Leaving the Farm. I've got a show on Thursday, 6 to 8 p.m. over on Revolution Radio at Freedom Footsteps.
Oh, okay. Great. I'll do that. And next Thursday, we'll have Dr. Carly here. She'll be here at 9 o'clock.
That's
so that's Eastern time, so I can come there and then come back here in time for this show, and you can join us with Dr. Carly.
Oh, that would be awesome. I love Dr. Carly.
Yeah, so both of y'all together will be great.
My goodness, I have to have two tablets.
Yeah, so Tami, please join us back next Thursday. I mean, of course, you know you're welcome any day, but I will definitely be on Revolution Radio Thursday between 6 and 8 p.m.
And if that doesn't work out for you, you can come on Saturday next week. I'll be back on. It's just this Saturday I traded with Kat for, she's having a special on Studio A with the Bowen Rocco show. She's interviewing Bowen Rocco, so I want to listen to that.
Okay. Great.
I'll be back.
And she's doing well? Kat's doing well?
She's
good.
So beautiful.
Yes, she is. She truly is. The Kat is on TCT Radio, y'all. Y'all would truly love that network. It's very relaxing, very, very commentative, very informative. You know, that is another great site. I mean, it's on basically almost all the time, isn't it, Tami?
that they're running 24 hours a day. That's a different cat, though. She's beautiful as well.
Yeah. I was talking about cat on TCT.
Yep.
Yes, and, you know, so, but truly I know Ron would, Ron is going to be so sad that he missed you.
Oh,
because
and
we've
I
been wanting to have you for so long.
Oh, and he's more than welcome to come on the show as well. I'm on Thursdays and Saturdays, and then on Saturday between 4 and 6, I'm also on No Borders Radio over on Scottish Sovereigns on the Land. So, and then TCT, we simulcast on Thursdays and Saturdays, normally on TCT as well.
Yes, well, I'm going to catch you on TCT. And I look forward to you being back here on Thursday.
Awesome. All right. I'll see you then. The phone's going to go dead anyway. I love you guys. Thanks
okay. Well, thank you again. I truly appreciate you coming, and I appreciate the work that you did with Congress to do something about this human trafficking. Thank you so much.
If you add me to Skype, I'll send you the U.S. documents and things and get everybody up to speed as well.
Okay, well, you know what? I'll do it through Niecy.
Okay.
And get it, and I'll have Niecy send you my email address.
Oh, awesome. All right, I'll see you then. Be well.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank
we
you.
Truly
Bye-bye.
Enjoyed you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Well, everyone, this was a great show.
Yes, it was.
And I'm just so honored that we have Brother Drybones that unfortunately his call has dropped. And that we also had Tami Peppermint, and she was just fantastic, wasn't she, y'all? I truly hope y'all enjoyed her, and I look forward to having her and Dr. Carly Thursday. So that is just going to be wonderful. That is going to be an exciting show. So, I'd like to thank y'all for coming. I truly hope that you enjoyed the show and that you got a lot of information out of it. And I'm not going to have a show this weekend, so I will see y'all back on Monday. Okay, so everyone have a good weekend. Thank you for coming tonight. We appreciate you, and we appreciate our guests. Yes, Wesley.
Yes, ma'am. If you want to speed your thinking up and your thought process, be really smart me. I'm telling you, you'll feel your brain and your thought pattern be so much faster if you get rid of that smart me. It's real talk. I have to keep telling you that. I'm telling you, you'll feel a lot better. I hate to keep saying that, but I want to see you get better.
No, I believe you. I believe you, sweetheart. But you got to remember, I have other complications besides a smart meter that came long before the smart meter.
Well, okay then. Well, okay then.
Yeah.
All right then.
Honey, I had problems before. I know, and I appreciate it truly, and I'm taking it to heart. But what I'm just telling you is I had a problem with my memory long before the smart meters.
Well, it will be enhanced, so take my word.
Yes, but I appreciate that, and I am definitely going to take care of that.
Okay. Peace and blessings. I'll catch y'all on the next episode.
Okay, thank you. Okay, honey, we'll see y'all Monday night. Have a good night, folks. And thank you
Peace
for coming.
Bless.
Good
same
night.
To you. Same to you. Okay, good night, folks. Have a good one. We'll see you Monday night. Bye.
Bye-bye.
All right.
Bye.